Ambassador O'Hanlon is tipped to win on preferences. It'll put more pressure on Liberal leader David Spears. While the Greens have been buoyed by their strong showing and are now eyeing the seat of Sturt at the next federal poll. And the latest news poll has seen the federal government's primary vote slip to 32%, while the coalition's lifted a point to 37%. But Anthony Albanese remains preferred prime minister. A pet dog was rescued by firefighters following a house fire at Salisbury East yesterday. They were called to Clayton Road just after 2:30. No one was home at the time. Spokesperson Sophie Clark says it was accidental.
Never leave a candle burning unattended in your home. When using candles, ensure the surrounding area is clear of combustible items. Do not place lit candles in windows where blinds or curtains may come into contact with the flame.
The damage bill is around $500,000. More than 500 households per week are seeking help to pay their electricity bills. Latest data from the Australian Energy Regulator shows 116,000 households are accessing hardship arrangements through their energy provider. That's a 59% increase since June 2022. More and more Australians are turning to overseas countries to avoid putting their loved ones into aged care at home. Teresa Wise moved to Thailand to receive care when her dementia rapidly progressed. Her husband James has told 60 Minutes there are more staff to provide around-the-clock aid to residents.
It suits me most of all because of the quantity of care that's available here. I know that Teresa has someone with her from 6 in the morning until 10 at night.
Russia is observing a day of mourning after at least 137 people were killed in an attack at a packed concert venue in Moscow. The BBC's Steve Rosenberg reports.
On this national day of mourning, there is a long queue of people outside the Krokus City Hall here. People queuing up with flowers, lining up at the makeshift shrine to the victims of this attack. And just from talking to people here, there is a deep sense of shock at what has happened. And a mixture, I'd say, of grief and also anger. One man said that he wanted President Putin to remove the moratorium on the death penalty.
And Donald Trump and his legal team are gearing up to face a New York court again tomorrow. The deadline for the former president to pay a $464 million US dollar bond is looming as he seeks to appeal a civil fraud judgment. If he fails to pay, orders could be made to seize his property. Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Colours, custom design, any house, any style. Gliderol Garage Doors, gliderol.com.au.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Port Adelaide has recorded its second win of the season after getting past Richmond by 5 goals in Travis Boak's 350th game at the MCG. Todd Marshall booted 4 goals and Jeremy Finlayson 3, while Zach Butters picked up 34 touches. In yesterday's other results, GWS smashed West Coast by 65 points, while the Bulldogs beat Gold Coast by 8 goals. Well, Oscar Piastri is content with his fourth placing at Albert Park in the Grand Prix yesterday. McLaren team bosses ordered the Australian to make way for Lando Norris, who finished third behind the two Ferraris. Piastri upbeat with the result.
A good result. Of course, I would have loved to have been one spot up, but no, pretty happy with that. A few little things that I could have done a bit better in that race. I think just struggled a little bit in that middle stint on the hard, but yeah, all in all, pretty happy with the race and good load of points for the whole team.
Let's go to basketball. The Tasmania Jack Jumpers have won Game 3 of the NBL Championship Series with a buzzer beater. This shot taking the Jack Jumpers to the winning score of 93-91 over Melbourne United.
Here's the Jack Jumpers' chance. McVay, 2 on the clock.
Oh, no!
Jack McVay! Oh, simply incredible! Jack McVay with the shot of his life! Tasmania win Game 3 and silence Melbourne!
What a fantastic match. That call on ESPN. Tasmania leads the series 2-1. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now the 5AA forecast. Sunny and 24 today. Mostly sunny tomorrow, 25. Sunny on Wednesday, 26. And 27 for Thursday. At the moment, 10. More news as it happens on 5AA.
You deserve your life-changing moment. You deserve life-changing care. You've only got 2 days to buy your tickets in the Hospital Research Foundation Home Lottery. You could win the fully furnished $3.6 million Scott Salisbury Grand Prize at Henley Beach. Plus, your tickets stay in more than 12,000 drawers, giving you a 1 in 15 chance to win. Hurry! Deadline Wednesday. Life-changing prizes. Life-changing impact. Homelottery.com.au. License M14493.
Hi, I'm Tim Angove from Supercraft Bedding. We're a small batch manufacturer of high quality mattresses, direct to public sales, but also commercial sales for government departments and defence use. We're more of a specialist manufacturer of mattresses. We decided to advertise on 5AA because they've got a very empowered and engaged audience, and we very much wanted to connect to that as our target market. The results were great and pretty much immediate. We realised people mentioning our ads, which was fun. It was a really funny ad that we had on at the time, and people loved to hear it and loved to have a chat and a joke about it when they came into the store.
To get your message out there and grow your business, visit 5AA.com.au and hit the Advertise With Us link for more information.
Roll up, roll up! Elmo's Circus Dream is coming to Adelaide for the first time. Catch all the fun of this fantastic theatre show with Elmo, his Sesame Street friends and amazing circus stars. Join Elmo and his friends as they discover their hidden circus talents with singing, dancing, acrobatics, illusions and much more. It'll be an unforgettable day of great family fun at Elmo's Circus Dream in Adelaide for a limited time from March 30. Get your tickets now at sesamestreetcircus.com.au.
Fresh nuts, melt-in-your-mouth chocolates and eye-popping Easter gifts. G'day folks, I'm Brett Charlesworth and there are 3 irresistible reasons to visit Charlesworth Nuts and make your family's Easter extra special. And here's 3 more. We're South Australian, we're 4th generation and still family owned, and on the Tuesday before Easter, Charlesworth Nuts turns 90 years young. You're always welcome at our 11 family-owned stores or shop online. Why Charlesworth? Because fresh nuts taste better.
Stay informed. Get involved.
5AA. Always Adelaide.
Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on. Touch base. Search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings. 5AA Breakfast.
8 minutes after 6, good morning to you. Welcome to Monday on 5AA Breakfast. It's the 25th of March. Huge program coming up for you today. Of course, we'll have all the fallout from the Dunstan by-election on Saturday, which hasn't yet yielded a definitive result, but basically has. Stacey Lee will have all the analysis for us after 7:30 this morning. We're also going to be chatting across the morning with local government minister Jeff Brock. Some big announcements expected to come a little bit later this week. We'll cross to the US for the latest there on the Moscow terror attack that dominated news headlines over the weekend. Just an absolutely horrific event. And also, in a much lighter vein, Costa Georgiadis is going to join us, we spoke to him this time last year, I think, the Ambassador of Neighbour Day that's taking place at the end of this week on the 31st of March. David Penberthy, good morning to you.
Good morning, listeners. Good morning, Will. Nice short week. Apart from for those working in emergency services or nursing, the people who keep the state safe and chugging along, but for the rest of us bludgers, a bit of a countdown till Friday and then Monday as well next week for the most important religious holiday of the year, Easter. Very much looking forward to it. And what about Saturday? I haven't checked it yet this morning, but as of last night on the bomb app, 31.
Let me jump. Should I?
Is it still 31?
A little teaser for the weather forecast.
It is beach weather.
31 on the 30th of March.
What about that?
28 on the Sunday as well.
Yeah. Sensational.
What a beautiful long weekend.
I always love
29
it.
29 on the Friday and sunny. It could be better.
If you can get one last beach swim in, that probably sounds a bit wussy for those iceberg types who, you know, middle of August when it, you know, 2 degrees, still jump in the briny. But I like to tap out on the Easter long weekend.
9.9 degrees outside at the moment. We're actually the coolest capital on the in the country outside of Canberra. Canberra's at 4.2. We're at 9.9. Everywhere else is kind of balmy. 16s in Hobart, 16.5 at the moment. Weirdly, heading for a top of 19. But yeah, here, 9.9 degrees. So it is a cool start to the day. The mornings are getting chilly now.
How long is Peter Malinauskas going to be Premier for?
Long as he wants.
Hmm. Yep.
Well, I reckon.
I was thinking about this last night. It's this might sound like a tangential observation, But I was casting my mind back to that moment in the state election campaign when those hopeless young libs decided to try to ambush him on his morning run.
Oh, they jogged alongside him.
Jogged along, all these, you know, country road catalogue, chambray shirted, boat shoe wearing, eastern suburbs types. You know, hey Pete, you know, trying to turn into some sort of stunt. And he just turned around and he goes, keep up, girls. Now, gendered language.
He got into trouble for it.
He got told off. David Spears, Michelle Linsink, they're all lining up to say this is endemic of some sort of women problem that the Labor Party had. I think that was like him being just a completely normal, relatable, suburban, borderline yobbo. And that there's that little story helps explain why it is that in an area that for 14 years has been, you know, solidly, well, up until the last election at least, was solidly behind Stephen Marshall. He's just got this sort of everyman quality that makes a lot of people, how many Liberal voters do you know who will take you aside and out the corner of their mouth go, don't mind Mally?
A lot of them. Lifelong Liberal people.
Yeah.
Don't like the Labor Party, but Mally's pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's a political phenomenon. Yeah, well, I think we live in a pretty extraordinary time in state politics in South Australia. That said, politics is a fickle beast. I mean,
very much so.
If there was I mean, it's a horrible thing to countenance, but if there was a ramping tragedy during the election campaign,
yeah,
that's the kind of thing that could derail things.
But it feels
but,
like.
But
it
I think in
like
the absence
it,
of something,
needs something like that.
Yeah, in the absence of something seismic happening, it's hard to imagine a scenario where he doesn't win multiple elections from here. That was a staggering result on the weekend. So you said it last week, I think in our chat with Matt Abraham, the standard swing to an opposition at a by-election is 4%.
Yeah, roughly.
4 to 6.
4 to 6.
This was minus 4%.
Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it?
So far, we should use...
Well, it'll come back a bit, you'd think.
Bragg is a bit of a cautionary tale. Because Bragg on the night that the voting stopped was at 50.5%, and after pre-polls and so forth, postals was counted, the margin got out to 56.5%. So it actually can shift a long way, probably not long enough to give Anna Finizio any real hope, but it might be more marginal than it's been reported thus far.
And I'll tell you what, the Greens, extraordinary vote, but their campaign was effectively run for them, mainly by the Liberal Party, but then also by both the Labor and Liberal parties with their, what you call mutually assured destruction, slinging so much crap at each other's candidates about, you know, conflicts of interest and Anna Finizio's job application, all that stuff, all that smear and...
You reckon the protest vote went to the Greens?
Well, I think a lot of people just looked at it and thought, listen to this rabble.
Yeah.
You know, people don't like that kind of negativity, that relentless negativity.
It's funny because the Greens vote, if you look at the federal... by-election of the seat of Dunkley in Melbourne southeast, got eviscerated.
Yeah, they collapsed.
So, but in Nord, it jumped significantly. Which I started thinking back as the numbers came in on Saturday night. To Jade spent 3 hours in the seat of Dunstan in Nord on Friday morning, just chatting to people. Sometimes people tell you what they think, and they're just being genuinely honest. Everyone said urban infill. Everyone, one person said ramping and health.
Yeah.
And we kind of went, and we spoke about it, going, oh, it's interesting to hear that that's something that comes up. Well, it was a genuine issue that neither of the major parties engaged in. But the Greens do. That's their whole thing.
I think, too, the antic stuff clearly didn't help the Libs in the final week. And I thought that Hanson Young jumping on board that was significant. But no, you're right. The thing, too, with the Greens, they seem to have got this excellent sort of capacity to sell part of their agenda to the type of otherwise genial middle-class women who like to get along to Adelaide Writers' Week. who don't look at the party in their totality. I mean, the Greens want to, you know, shut down the South Australian defence industry, defund the police, and stop giving money to every private school in the country. And in the South Australian context, you know, all the big ones are in the seat of Norwood. So that's Saints, PAC, Loretto, like, you name it, the list goes on. Big fans of, you know, well, you wouldn't say they're fans of Hamas, but they sort of sound a bit like they are sometimes. Mm, they're
sympathetic.
Mm. And
they're not big on getting your power bills down either.
No, no. I think that the current pricing is sort of, well, suck it up. Mm. You know, we need to move to a renewables future. So almost everything which totally jars with mainstream opinion. Yet, if the number one issue in your head is that there's a ghastly five-bedroom apartment complex going up on Port Rush Road, then they're the party for you.
That's exactly right. What were your thoughts, folks? It was a big weekend for South Australian politics. Insight into the mind of the voters. We've gotten them in the absence of any news poll or anything like that. There was a federal news poll out as well. We might talk about that a little bit later. But as always, we're most interested in your thoughts. 8223 0000. Shoot us a text on the Dutton's text line. Dutton's Ford, why wait? Ranger in stock now for immediate delivery. Dutton's, easy to do business with. News headlines are next.
Sorrow is the sucker punch that takes the wind out of you. Just when you start to focus again, grief cloaks you in darkness. But then you feel yourself lifted into the light. Distinctive Funerals. Your strength when you have none. DistinctiveFunerals.com.au.
It's Edward here from Edwardstown Mazda.
Thanks, Edward. I've got this. And it's big news.
How big?
Really big. Edwardstown Mazda have extended their sale with huge Mazda factory bonuses across a wide range of Mazdas. Plus, get a $2,000 trade-in bonus on top of your trade-in price. Only available at Edwardstown Mazda.
Wow.
I know, right? Wow.
Play the jingle sing.
It's gotta be.
Edwardstown Mazda. T's and C's apply.
In Australia, around 2,300 children are living with childhood dementia, which takes 91 lives every year.
If you're anything like us, you want to know what you can do to help. Well, thankfully, two local legends are teaming up to make a difference and giving you the opportunity to join them.
South Australian charity, the Little Heroes Foundation, is dedicated to finding treatments for and eventually curing childhood dementia. And South Australian salad producer, High Fresh Salads, is committed to doing its part.
Purchase any High Fresh Salads prepackaged salad featuring the Little Heroes logo and part proceeds will go towards the fight to end childhood dementia while providing support for families in need.
You can find High Fresh Salads prepackaged salads at your local independent supermarket and greengrocer.
5AA's Tech Talk with your host, Adelaide Tech Guy Richard Pascoe. Thanks to Harvey Norman Computers.
Whether it's the latest Samsung Galaxy S24 or the latest Apple iPhone 15, Harvey Norman has you covered. Head in store to sign up to a new Optus $69 a month, 24-month SIM-only plan. And you'll get unlimited calls and texts to standard numbers and 100 gigabytes of data for use in Oz. Plus, you'll receive an $800 Harvey Norman gift card when you sign up. Tell them I sent you and you'll score a further $100 gift card. That's $900 towards your new phone. With a deal this good, there's some fine print. Minimum plan costs $1,656 over 24 months. Maximum of 5 gift cards per account. Recontracts and rate plan changes excluded. Plan cancellation fees apply. See in store for details.
Check out this great offer at a Harvey Norman store near you. 5AA Breakfast is streaming live right now. To watch, simply head to 5AA on Facebook or YouTube. Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on, touch base, search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings. 5AA Breakfast.
9 minutes after 6. A few texts coming in on the Dutton's text line. We might let a few of them percolate and we'll get to them in just a moment. First news headlines. A Donald Bradman match-used cricket bat has sold for more than $165,000 in an Adelaide auction over the weekend. Bradman used it to score the lazy 223 in under 5 hours against the West Indies in Brisbane in the 1930-31 Test Series. The bat also has signatures from the Australian and West Indies teams. It was had been kept in storage since it was last used, apart from a brief stint at the Bradman Museum. I'm actually surprised it didn't go for more, given what we know, especially Indian cricket collectors, cashed up Indian cricket collectors will pay for things.
Yeah, it's crazy.
165 grand feels like a bit of a steal, I reckon.
165. It would hold its value.
could only gain value, surely.
Incredible.
Long-time Liberal member for Gray, Rowan Ramsay, has announced he will not contest the next federal election. Gray is Australia's third largest electorate, covers more than 90% of South Australia, and Mr. Ramsay served as the MP for the seat since 2007.
Who are we going to ring on election night now?
Well, I know that's our running joke on election night, yeah. Is we call Gray 1 second after the polls close.
Yeah, 7:01, crossing out of Port Pirie.
Rowan Ramsay was announced his victory.
He's a good bloke. Excellent bloke.
He's one of those MPs that doesn't sound like a politician. And I say that...
No.
As a
compliment.
A compliment.
Yeah, yeah. I wonder who's going to get the seat.
A man was arrested...
I'm sure that'll all be handled smoothly by the South Australian Liberal Party.
I can't see there being any issue whatsoever.
No, he's really good at picking people for seats. It's good.
A man was arrested on Saturday after he allegedly assaulted a retail worker at Marion Shopping Centre last week. He supposedly headbutted a member of staff at a shop there. The police located the 26-year-old suspect on Saturday, and searching his house, they also found property stolen from a break-in at Mitchell Park and 51 LSD tablets. Funnily enough, it turns out people who assault people in shops probably do other bad things.
Yeah, there appears to be a link, doesn't there? Yeah.
The man will face court in May of charges of aggravated assault, serious criminal trespass, theft, and trafficking a commercial quantity of a controlled drug.
Unbelievable.
One of Australia's largest ports has been the site of another pro-Palestinian demonstration. Unionists, advocates and political figures, including Paul Keating, Green Senator Maureen Faruqi, have spent the night there protesting against the docking of an Israeli ship at Port Botany. Palestine Justice Movement spokesman Ahmed Abadla says there is support that is important to the campaign.
They are very strong in their support with the Palestinian community. It's like the way they supported South African people against apartheid South Africa, the way they supported the population in Vietnam against the colonisation project, and we're very lucky to have their support.
More than 500 households per week are seeking help to pay their electricity bills. Latest data from the Australian Energy Regulator shows 116,000 households are accessing hardship arrangements through the energy provider, a 59% increase since June 2022.
The numbers are staggering, aren't they?
And does the RBA look at that? Doesn't feel like an input into the decision-making process.
It should be.
Yeah, it doesn't, but it doesn't feel like it is.
No, and the rate at which people are turning to special bill smoothings and... But the thing is, you can't outrun the bills.
They
pile up still.
Yeah, exactly. Shocking. Right. The federal opposition is calling for harsh penalties for people filming videos of criminal activity and posting it online. The party will introduce a bill into Parliament which seeks to impose social media bans and even jail time for those behind the so-called post and boast videos. Shadow Communications Minister David Coleman says the issue is growing nationwide.
This is everywhere, and many of these crimes are shocking. Things like home invasions, things like violent assaults. And people see those videos online, and some people then say, well, I'll do that myself.
You wonder if it would apply for school-age people, because that's where, you know, all those shocking videos of kids being beaten up and, you know, then it gets treated as some sort of, you know, comic sort of event online. It's just appalling. Hasn't social media really covered itself in glory with the treatment of Princess Kate too? My God.
Oh.
Just disgusting. Like the number of people, not people with pseudonyms, not people hiding behind made-up names, but actual real people, some of them so-called celebrities and influencers, some of these half-wits that you see cackling away on panel discussion shows, all peddling their own theories about what's going on with Kate. They should all hang their heads in shame. It's just disgusting.
Her being moved to have to put out that video over the weekend, which she did like everything she does. It was incredibly classy and... honest and genuine, but I watched it and thought, is this because three idiots went and hacked into your medical records and this was about to come out anyway?
Possibly. Yeah.
I mean, what a horrible intrusion into your private. There's nothing more private than your health.
No.
Just awful.
Disgusting.
It's warmed up a little bit outside. We're up to 10.4 degrees outside at the moment. Top of 24 today. It's as cool as it's going to get. That is a maximum over the course of this week. 25 on Tuesday. Some sunny days on Wednesday and Thursday, 26 and 27. Sunny and even warmer on Friday, 29. Saturday gets to 31, as we've just spoken about, and Sunday, 28 as well. So the Easter long weekend is looking absolutely magnificent.
I'm waiting with bated breath for the arrival of Tom Wren.
Are you?
I feel like it's going to be great a great segment for Port supporters, and for the rest of us, not so much. Unbelievable.
I suspect so. Albeit there was a lot of upset Port supporters before three-quarter time on the call yesterday.
Well, they got there, though.
They got
well
there.
Well and
did.
Truly.
They did. There was a professional job in the end. When the UV's 3 and above, cover up your sun protection, stay sun smart, and download the Sun Smart app. Today, it's rated at 7, which is still considered high. So take all the precautions. We'll get to some text shortly. But first, Rennie's in the 5AA Breakfast Studio live on the Foodland Supermarkets Facebook and YouTube live stream. Morning to you, Rennie.
Morning, Will. Morning, David. Winners and losers, shall we? We'll start with the game you called yesterday, Will. Travis Boak's 350th. He's a winner. Port Adelaide a winner. It didn't look great at half time. You called the game, did it beautifully with Tredders and Timmy G, but great second half, 13 goals to 6. It was a really good result for the Power yesterday.
Always felt like they're on top. They squandered a lot of opportunities in the first quarter, and then were really ordinary. Port were ordinary in that second quarter, but other than that, I think they controlled the game. There was a shocking bounce at the end of the third quarter. I don't know if you saw it. Liam Baker scored his second goal in a minute on account of a bounce not being recalled. Honestly, this thing, not only did it leave the centre circle, it just about was first touched out in centre wing. It advantaged Richmond and they kicked it. And then that made it look like it was a lot closer, I think, than it actually was in reality. Port were on top and the better side.
Yeah, and, you know, Todd Marshall and Jeremy Finlayson, 7 goals between them. Mm. Zach Butters, again, outstanding, 34 and a goal. Connor Rosie, 28. And I thought Willem Drew stepped up in the absence of Jason Horne-Francis. So, you know, they did do well at the start of that last quarter when the game was on the line. The first 10 minutes were great. So, good result. They're 2-0. There's still stuff to work on, but it's a good start for Port. They needed to just sort of take care of
business.
Well,
on the road, at the MCG, and, you know, I know a lot of people like you, Tom, have written off Richmond, but there's still a quality. We've got a lot of quality players.
Yep.
And with the crowd behind them the way they always are at the G, I think it's a massive win for Port.
Yeah, it's good, and it gives them, you know, real confidence and belief heading
and
into this.
And for Travis Boak, obviously.
And for Boak, good recognition of his 350th and a huge game now this week at home against Melbourne, who look resurgent once more. So if they can win that and bank 3 early wins, then that's a really good start. We'll go to the losers because it relates to football. Friday night, I called that game. Boy, oh boy.
Garbage.
I think Scott Camporeale sort of said in the call, don't get beaten by what you know. And how many times have the Crows been towed up by Geelong halfbacks having a picnic? Tom Stewart absolutely owned Adelaide on Friday night. It was infuriating.
That was a coaching fail, I reckon, Rennie.
It was horrific. They just got smashed behind the ball.
Starting Luke Pedler on him? I reckon that was pretty dubious.
Yeah.
Natural attacking player, and you've got some blokes that you pick every week who's for the defensive acumen in Keys and Murphy. And then that didn't work, which surprised, I think, no one. And the plan B was, oh, well, Tom, run around and do your best.
Yeah.
Oh, that was...
But don't you reckon, too, okay, fair whack, but there's a few players you need to just pull their fingers out. Like, I think in a week where Matthew Nix is just, you know, they made the announcement that he signed for another 2 years, the players didn't really do him a solid by bowling up that tripe.
Yeah.
There's a few guys on that list who are still showing great promise, and they're at the point where they should, you know... Time you know what will get off the pot.
Yeah, and what's frustrating is the system. You know, what was so good last year was the connection between midfield and forward. 24 inside 50s in the second term for 2 goals. It just
Where's the attacking footy gone?
They just could not make
scoring
it work.
Team of the comp last year.
Yeah, and...
Well, they were exciting to watch last year, though. You felt proud watching them last year, even when they lost, which might sound a bit silly, but, they, you know, young side, having a real crack. It was the having a crack part seems to have disappeared.
Mm. Yeah, it's frustrating, and the season can slip away quickly. I mean, they've got Fremantle away talking of big games. That's on Friday night. That's a huge
game. Then Melbourne, then Carlton.
Yeah.
In Melbourne.
They cannot afford to be, you know, sort of 1-4. But
are you that optimistic?
Yeah. Got to somehow get 2 of the next 3, and Fremantle away is going to be really tough, but need to do it. Just quickly, other winners, Ferrari and Carlos Sainz. Good to see Ferrari back and firing. They went 1-2. Nick Percat as well in the supercars was outstanding. The Tassie Jack Jumpers with a buzzer beater, they could win the NBL title. They're 1 game away, so great to see them playing so well. 2-1 up in a best of 5. And Western Australia cricket, 3 in a row for the Sheffield Shield. Smashed Tasmania by 377 runs. They're a dominant force in domestic cricket at the moment, so well done to the Sandgropers.
Absolutely. Good on you, Rennie.
Good on you, boys.
Gliderol Garage Doors, adding strength, style and safety to your home. Gliderol.com.au.
This is 5AA News. Always Adelaide.
Sunny in 24, 6:30 News. I'm Kendall Brettig.
From chips to replacements, make Complete Windscreens your insurer repairer of choice. CompleteWindscreens.com.au.
The Liberals are set to lose the state's most marginal seat, with Labor poised to snare the eastern suburb seat of Dunstan after the weekend's by-election. It's been more than a century since Labor held the seat, with leader David Spears now under mounting pressure from within the Liberals. And a new opinion poll shows an increasing number of voters are losing faith with the major parties. Michael Packey reports from Canberra.
The latest news poll shows Labor's primary vote has collapsed to 32%. It means if a federal election were held now, Anthony Albanese would likely need the support of independents and minor parties to govern. While the Liberals' primary vote sits at 37%, they struggle to win the preferences of other political parties to help get them over the line. The poll shows that 31% of voters have abandoned both major parties, a trend mirrored over the weekend in the Tasmanian election, with neither Liberal or Labor winning enough seats to govern the state in their own right.
Cost of living pressures are seeing continual rates of households accessing electricity hardship arrangements. Since June last year, over 500 a week have entered into hardship arrangements with their electricity providers. And supermarket giants will be facing some awkward questions when they front a parliamentary inquiry this week into pricing and market power figures. The Greens are calling for Coles and Woolies to sell some supermarkets under new legislation. John Kehoe from the Financial Review says there is division over support for the proposal.
The Greens have got support from the Nationals, so one of the retail unions also supporting it, but then the broader union movement saying, oh, we don't think this would be good, and big business also worried that this might affect jobs and investment too.
Hundreds of activists have gathered at Port Botany rallying against Israeli shipping line Zim. The group blocked the roadway and access to the port as it demanded stronger sanctions in response to conflict in the Middle East. 19 people have been arrested. Russia has launched fresh missile attacks on Kyiv after blaming Ukraine for a terror attack which has left 137 people dead. The US says there's no evidence of Ukrainian involvement, with Islamic State claiming responsibility for the massacre. Counter-terrorism expert Clive Williams says the incidents accelerated tension between Russia and Ukraine.
He's now trying to focus the blame on Ukraine, and of course that supports his special military operation into Ukraine. So that's what he's trying to do, shift the blame and use disinformation to make it appear as though Ukraine was responsible.
The royal family is pushing back pressure to take on more royal duties as they grapple with the Princess of Wales and the King's cancer treatment. More from UK correspondent Jessica Millwood.
The Prince and Princess of Wales have headed to their holiday home in Norfolk with their three children to spend some quality time together over Easter after Kate's shock news she is battling cancer. It means the family won't be at the traditional Easter Sunday Mass in Windsor. Meanwhile, in an interview with Sky News Australia, the King's nephew, Peter Phillips, has revealed the monarch remains in good spirits, but is frustrated he can't get back to full-time work just yet.
Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Gliderol Garage Doors, adding strength, style and safety to your home. Gliderol.com.au.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Port Adelaide coach Ken Hinckley says he was delighted with the response of his players after they responded to record a 30-point win against Richmond at the MCG. The Power trailed by 11 points at half-time but came back with 13 goals to 6 after half-time, and the coach says credit needs to go to his players.
It was a good sign, I think, for me, for the maturity of the team and the group, that they realised what wasn't working so well for them, and they were capable of change, which makes a big difference in an AFL game.
It certainly does. Two other games yesterday, with Melbourne making light work of Gold Coast, winning by 48 points in Ballarat, while in the late game, GWS destroyed West Coast by 65 points. Despite that result, Eagles coach Adam Simpson is adamant his side is constantly improving. Simpson says his side made simple mistakes, which made the deficit look greater than it should have been.
For a good quarter and a half, I think halfway through the second to halfway through the third, we just lost our way with the fundamentals. But I think we win the general play contest, win the clearances between the arcs. There's some stuff there that we're really chasing that we saw some improvement on last year, but we've still got a lot of work to do.
And a buzzer beater from Jack McVay has seen the Tasmanian Jack Jumpers beat Melbourne United 93-91. That was in Game 3 of the NBL Championship Series. Tassie now leads the best of five series, 2-1. And that's the 5AA sport.
Now the 5AA forecast, sunny in 24 today, mostly sunny tomorrow 25, sunny on Wednesday 26 and 27 for Thursday. At the moment 11. More news as it happens on 5AA.
Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on, touch base, search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings. 5AA Breakfast.
24 minutes to 7. Gardening Australia host and Neighbour Day ambassador, Costa Georgiadis, is going to join us in just a moment. We'll talk about the importance of relationships with your neighbour, but also we might ask him for a few gardening tips, given we had a weirdly wet summer and then we've had a late hot, well, a hot start to autumn.
We had a very wet December and then an incredibly dry, almost a record dry February, March. And still no sign of rain for the next week. Things are looking really dry. So we'll get some timely tips from our good mate Costa.
We'll do that in just a moment. First, John and Glenside's called into the program. Morning to you, John.
Good morning, gentlemen. Lovely to talk to you.
You too, John.
We're going to get very expensive nuclear subs, which will produce nuclear waste, and they're going to take a long, long time before they are ready for us. However, nuclear reactors for power said no, too long, too expensive, and of course, where are we going to put the nuclear waste? Why has no new service that I have heard, obviously, not that I have heard, said anything about this small conundrum?
Well, John, in our defence, we've been banging that drum for a while. We are paid up converts to the nuclear cause, and you're dead right, I think, pointing out the absurd anomaly. I mean, you know, we've had the Prime Minister, we've had Penny Wong, we've had Tanya Plibersek all saying, no, nuclear doesn't make economic sense, and where are we going to put the waste at the same time as they've signed the AUKUS deal?
That's right. Yeah.
We're in passionate agreement with you, John.
I haven't been listening hard enough to you. I don't listen to every word you say.
They don't all make sense.
Oh, go on. They're not too bad.
Good on you, John.
Good on you, John. Thanks, mate. It's a great... I mean, historically, the strongest argument against nuclear power generation was, well, yeah, you might think it's good, but then what do you do with the waste? But when it comes to August, it's like, well, we'll sort out the waste.
Oh, yeah.
Don't worry about that.
Yeah, look at what happened in Kimber.
Yeah, what could possibly go wrong?
That's right.
22-7, as we mentioned right at the start of the program this morning, the excellent Neighbour Day is coming up on 31st of March, which is a great cause with a terrific message, but also it means we get to chat with our next guest, which is always very enjoyable. Costa Georgiadis is... Gardening Australia's host, you might know him from ABC television, but of course, too, is the ambassador for Neighbour Day coming up later this week. Costa, good morning to you, and welcome to 5AA Breakfast.
Hi, David. Hi, Will. How are you, mate?
Yeah, we're good, Costa. Great to be chatting with you again, mate. So, the whole idea of, like, you know, feeling connected, feeling like you're part of a community, it's quite depressing, really, when you think about it, how... new people can move in next door, and sometimes you can just never even get around meeting them.
Yeah, it's true. And you know, the statistic that kind of staggers me is that in the 18 to 25-year-old zone, the most kind of digitally connected generation, they're the loneliest in the country. Like, and that upsets me. Like, that, you know, at that age, we've got loneliness in the community when, you know, it means that people's neighbourhoods in their actual physical life are becoming so specific. Like, I go to work if I go to work, or I work from home and I'm indoors. And that interaction it's kind of, we've literally in this digital age become so, I want it now. You know, this took 3 days to get delivered from the US that I bought. And like, there's this overarching urgency that I need everything at my fingertips. And, you know, in that process, we kind of lose out on the world where we actually do live, like those people closest to us. When all of that, the rest of the world shuts down and there's an emergency, who are the ones that come first? It's the person over the road there. But
yeah,
how
exactly.
often do I invest in that relationship? Or like we, you know, and it doesn't take a lot. That's the bit that I love, you know, around this whole thing is we need to make that little effort. And once you make that little effort, just a wave. And then they mightn't wave back the first time, you know. Rejection, you know, don't worry about that. Just do it again. You don't know what the conditions are. And those little actions of, you know, I've got neighbours, you know, with kids down the street. And whenever I see them, you know, the kids call out. And if I hear them, you know, if I'm here sitting inside and I hear them call out on their way to school, I'll scream out and, you know, and then if I've got something to give them, and you know, then they look out the window when they come around the corner and start to make, you know, and I see people from the units opposite, you know, first step was to say g'day, and then they have a look at the garden, what's this, oh, what's your name?
Well, I wanted to ask you about the garden, because often the garden can be the ultimate icebreaker for neighbours, and I'm a keen veggie gardener, and one of our neighbours, we have a little system where, you know, you end up with too many tomatoes or a whole pile of quinces or something like that. And we have a hook that we pass stuff back and forth over the fence. And some mornings I'll go out and there'll be, you know, 30 limes off Jim's lime tree. Like, it's a terrific little thing.
Yeah, and like there's a Jim or a Mary, like in every suburb, yearning for that little connection. Mm. And I just, if I harvest something, I know that I can drop it down. My neighbour is Roz. Who I've known for years and years. And I'll just, if I've got tomatoes when I'm harvesting, I just take them down. And if she's there, awesome. I just ring the doorbell, we have a yarn. But if not, there's a pot right near the door that I just sit them in there. And then sure enough, when she'll see my car in or she'll see me out in the garden, she'll come up. And I shared her some pumpkin because I was going away. And, you know, whenever I know I'm going to be away for a few days and I'm not going to get through this food, there's my cue, and I take it down there. And then yesterday, lo and behold, I was out there in the street garden. Rosie comes up, and she goes, oh, look, Kosa, I made this cake. She said, I used your pumpkin. I made a pumpkin and blueberry cake, and she said it was so good. She said, I had to freeze you this piece because I was going to eat it all. And you just think, you know, isn't that nice? I'm affecting her life with one action, and then that's built this, oh, I'll give this to him down the track. And, you know, she's in her 90s. And, you know, people need interaction during their days. And I can do that. And I'm not even around, yet I'm in her orbit. And she knows I'm here. And that's what's that idea of, you know, you've got to create belonging. It's not just going to happen. We can't make a suburban neighbourhood without, like, it just doesn't happen. It's not written up as, oh, I live in, you know, the neighbourhood of Bexley or you know, the beachside neighbourhood. It's got to become that through our actions. And yeah, I just love that idea that it's not big things. You don't have to invite people round for dinner. You just need those little exchanges that make someone's day.
I like that gardening is an icebreaker. I think that's so true. It's true. We're not even massive gardeners at our place, but our next-door neighbours are. And they've got a pomegranate tree, and they were one of the first interactions we had was them saying, hey, help yourself. Or if they drop on your side, let us know if it's an issue. And otherwise, but if there's any fruit that you want, just go for it. But it was a totally organic reaction that was brought about by gardening, which is something else we wanted to ask you about, Costa, because we've been having this discussion here in South Australia, and I don't think we're unique on this front. But we've just had a weird couple of seasons. So summer was super wet, then late it got really dry, and now into autumn we've suddenly got a lot of warmth. How are you dealing with the fact that the Australian seasons seem to be changing in a way that it doesn't feel like they're bouncing back anytime soon?
Yeah, you're really hitting the nail on the head, here, because, you know, for a long time, you know, it all got caught up with this camp, you know, oh, you know, the climate change, it doesn't exist. Climate change, it does exist. You're in your camp, I'm in my camp. But it's not about getting caught in those big picture realities. It's the little things. And when you start to realise, you know, it gets wet, plants, flowers don't hold. If the flowers don't hold, then the insects don't get their food. We drop the insects. So then the next season, people are like, oh, I didn't really get much pollination. Why? Because the insects didn't have a chance. And so it's, again, the little things that start to affect us. So it's not like this massive change, because, you know, anyone can grab stats and go, oh, but we've had the same amount of rainfall. Well, that's all rubbish. Yeah, but that same amount of rainfall has now fallen across summer when it was normally spread across multiple months. So now we have this wet period and then a long dry. And that's what a lot of people talk to me about when I travel, that these shifts are happening. And, you know, the questions come up. Oh, it's gotten humid all of a sudden. All my leaves have got mold on them. Or it's rained so much I didn't get fruit set. And so I didn't get my tomatoes. The tomato season this year was a shocker. I got off to a great start in September, October, was looking good into November, December, ready to start harvesting them, and then bang, the rain set in, and I barely saw any, you know, and with the rain came the slugs, and then there was a rat, and then there was birds, and, you know, all these things. So, yeah, I think the best thing we can do about it is talk about it.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Because the more we talk about it, the more it becomes part of our consciousness. And the more we start to appreciate that, you know, we may have to start to do things differently. And those usual markers that have been markers for decades, they're no longer fixed on those calendar days or weeks anymore. You know, we've actually got to go out. This is one of my dad's his classic sayings. Where people say, oh, what's the weather going to be like tomorrow? Oh, well, I'll tell you tomorrow. I'll put my head out the window. And yeah, it was the same question people used to ring up and, you know, say, oh, it's cost a home. And Dad's best line. And see, I never got it because it was about me. And he'd say, he'll be home when he walks in the door.
Well, it's a great message ahead of Neighbour Day, March 31. And as Costa says, you know, you don't need to invite your neighbours round for dinner. Well, you can if you want, but it's more just a quick, hey, mate, we've met. My name's Dave. My name's Will. Yeah. My name's Costa. Great message, Costa, and thanks for sharing it this morning. Costa Georgiadis there, obviously, best known as the Gardening Australia host. Great program. Been watching that for years, but also, importantly, Ambassador for Neighbour Day on March 31.
All right, let's check traffic. When the UV is 3 and above, cover up, use sun protection, stay sun smart, download the Sun Smart app.
Thanks, Will, and morning, David, at Windsor Gardens. Traffic lights out on Northeast Road near Pittman Road and also Innes Road. At Elizabeth, the Bruce Water Main North Road near Woodford Road, got two lanes closed with speeds at 40, and urgent electrical works at Prospect today. Churchill Road near Olive Street, speeds reduced there too. You'll find a camera this morning, Chunga Road at Chunga. Hot flight deals have landed at flights that don't fly Adelaide to Los Angeles return from $1,691. Hurry ends Wednesday. Book in-store or online today. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Fresh nuts, melt-in-your-mouth chocolates and eye-popping Easter gifts. G'day folks, I'm Brett Charlesworth, and there are three irresistible reasons to visit Charlesworth Nuts and make your family's Easter extra special. And here's three more. We're South Australian, we're fourth generation and still family owned, and on the Tuesday before Easter, Charlesworth Nuts turns 90 years young. You're always welcome at our 11 family owned stores or shop online. Why Charlesworth? Because fresh nuts taste better.
Live Golf Adelaide is back, and tickets are selling fast. It's golf, but louder. Don't miss this epic weekend, packed with live music, party vibes, and world-class golfers like Rahm, Smith, and Koepka. Live Golf Adelaide, April 26th to 28th. Get your tickets now at livegolf.com.
Now, we're just talking about gardens, Will.
Yes.
The revelation about your neighbours, your very neighbourly neighbours with their pomegranate tree, yet your garden still...
Ours isn't great, but we live around greatness, which, you know, a bit like you, but you live amongst greatness.
Yeah, our neighbours, particularly Jim on the other side, I love his garden. It's a sprawling native mess of a thing. But look, if you're thinking about starting a garden, or maybe you've got a garden and you just want to totally change it, get into Stanford's, because at Stanford's, they don't just talk gardens, they want to see your photographs.
A picture's worth a thousand words, and nothing makes the Stanford team's day like a photo of your pride and joy, your garden.
And look, over the years, 100 years of combined experience in the team, they've seen the lot. They want to see your unusual garden, your work in progress, your new veggie patch, the time you dabbled in hedge sculpting. They want to see it all. They're a wealth of knowledge when it comes to tips and tools to keep your garden pristine.
So pop in for tips, or just to brag to someone who gets it. Go see Ben and Archie and their experienced team at 590 Main North Road, Jepps Cross, or check out stanfordmowers.com.au.
Right now with Bupa, get up to 10 weeks free when you join on eligible products, plus up to 700 everyday rewards dollars. T's and C's apply. For award-winning health insurance, search Bupa 10 weeks free today.
Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on. Touch base. Search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings. 5AA Breakfast.
9 minutes to seven. Let's talk about the weather for not just the working week ahead, but indeed the long Easter weekend. Hannah Marsh is on duty at the Bureau of Meteorology this morning. Hannah, take us through it.
Good morning, Dave and Will. We've had a minimum of 9.4 degrees. Currently, we're sitting on 10.9. There is a little bit of cloud around at the moment, but this should clear as we head deeper into the morning period. We're looking at a maximum of 24 degrees in the city, 26 at Elizabeth, 23 at Glenelg, 23 also at Norlunga, and 24 for Mount Barker. Then as we head into tomorrow, we're generally looking at the temperatures increasing. We've got 25 for tomorrow, mostly sunny, getting up to 26 on Wednesday and 27 on Thursday. Then as we head into the Easter long weekend, we're looking at it warming up, 29 degrees on Friday, 31 for Saturday. Then on Sunday, there's a little bit of model uncertainty at this stage as to how far moisture in the north pushes down over the south. But there is the chance of seeing a possible shower. At this stage, not much in it, and looking at 28 degrees for Easter Sunday.
Lovely stuff. Beautiful for the long weekend. Thank you, Hannah.
All right, let's head to SAPOL. Senior Constable Jen Cullinan joins us. Jen, we've had someone driving like an idiot at Roseworthy.
Yes, we have. What a tool. So it was about 7:45 last night. Police were conducting speed detection duties on the Teal Highway when they detected a Ford sedan travelling at 150 in a 100 zone.
Crikey.
So surprisingly, patrols lost sight of that vehicle and searched the area. And a short time later, they located the vehicle on Stolberg Road at Freeling, and the driver attempted to walk from the area. So the 44-year-old man was arrested, and he's been charged with numerous traffic offences, including excess speed, speed dangerous, no licence, hinder, and breach of bail. And he's got himself a date with the magistrate this morning.
Breach of bail? So he's on bail when he was doing all this rat baggery, Jen?
And he had no licence.
Yeah, well,
on his best behaviour.
Yeah.
Yeah, tool of the week.
Yeah, absolutely.
So far, followed swiftly by the next tool of the week.
Oh, let's hear about him.
It's a crowded field.
The next one was about 10 past 10 last night, and patrols stopped a Ford sedan on Aerodrome Road at Malala for a random driver test, and the driver, a 55-year-old man from Paralawi, provided a positive result of 0.292, which, doing the maths, is nearly six times the limit.
Jeez.
So he's been reported, he's had his vehicle taken, he's got a 12-month instant loss of licence, and he's going to go to court at a later date.
Remarkable.
Tool of the week, I like it, Jen.
Tool of the week.
Yeah, we cover, unfortunately, Monday morning, we've got some stellar candidates.
Yeah, I know, and it's only Monday.
Exactly, thank you for that. Senior Constable Jen Cullinan from SOPOS. There's two people that, people make mistakes, they're not mistakes.
Nah, they're lifestyle choices.
That's right, exactly. People don't give us stuff.
These guys are going pro.
Yeah.
You know, if you're on bail, you haven't got a license, you clearly couldn't give a toss about anyone else.
Going 150, 100.
But, you know, let's just see what happens to this bloke.
I'm sure he's got a very touching story.
Mm.
6 minutes to seven. Let's head to the US. Tim Lester for 7 News joins us. Tim, all eyes in the US, like around the world, are on Moscow in Russia after that horrible terror attack over the weekend. Good morning to you.
Yes, morning, guys. A death toll now climbing to 137. We've seen pictures overnight of the Russian president lighting a candle in a church to pay respects to the dead. He's been very circumspect in his comments though, Vladimir Putin, since the attack on the concert venue, suggesting, though not flat out saying, that there was some connection with Ukraine in this. Now, that, of course, happily suits Vladimir Putin's agenda to muster local Russian backing for his war in Ukraine. The US vice president has also spoken, Kamala Harris, in the last 24 hours and has says that there is no evidence that US intelligence can see of any Ukrainian involvement. It was a straightforward case of the terror group, Islamic State, the faction of that group based in Afghanistan who carried out this attack.
I thought, Tim, that it emerged over the weekend that the US intelligence had actually picked up on some chatter around this a couple of weeks ago and had actually passed that on to Moscow.
It did, and not only to Moscow, its embassy in Moscow warned Americans there that they had particular chatter that there could be attacks on, among other things, concert venues. Now, they did say at the time that there was a heightened risk in the next 48 hours, but that they'd seen this risk of attack on concert venues. After that and before his re-election in that dubious national vote for 6 years, Vladimir Putin called this Western blackmail and essentially poured cold water on the warning. But US officials are now saying they gave at least some of the intelligence to Russian officials, despite the frostiness of the relations between the two. And obviously that did little good in terms of preventing the attack.
The other thing too, Tim, a lot of people probably thought Islamic State had disappeared as a force, given the relative lack of this type of, you know, French Bataclan-style terror over the last 6 months or so, well, probably even longer. But this is a reminder that they're still very much a force to be reckoned with.
And in fact, it does exactly that. If you like, it is in a way... calibrates their capacity to attack. It's a sense of how dangerous they remain, and it's also a sense, perhaps, of the extent to which Russia's security forces are focused on Ukraine and focused on the political needs of Vladimir Putin, perhaps, instead of ordinary state security that Russians demand. And that's why this attack, being as successful as it was, is potentially really damaging for Vladimir Putin.
100%. Good on you, Tim. Tim Lester there for 7 News in the US Bureau. Thanks, mate.
All right, 5AA News is coming up. We'll take you through a wrap of the overnight and weekend stories after 7. Lots to talk about, certainly the world of politics too. Stacey Lee, she's coming off the long run as well after 7:30, given what we know about the Dunstan by-election result. And then a little bit later in the morning, we're going to chat with Jeff Brock. We've canvassed on this program some big changes to the way the local government's going to work. There's going to be some announcements this week, and Jeff Prock will join us after 8:30.
One of them is term limits for councils, which I think is really interesting. And the other one, the biggie, is going to be, and the government hasn't got a hard and fast position on this yet, but would you support compulsory voting in local council elections? That is, do you think people should be fined for not voting? Hop to it on the text line,
The
Dutton's text line, folks, and give us a call, 822-3000. But we'd like to start getting a sense of what our listeners are saying before the minister comes on at 8:30. I reckon term limits, brilliant idea, but being forced, but threat of an actual financial fine for voting, not so much.
Treat your family and friends to something a little fancy from Fascina, your family liquor stores. Autumn brings some stunning colours and amazing SA-made wine varieties like smooth and fruity Pinot Noir, Tempranillo and Grenache. We have exciting new vodkas and gins and lovely liqueurs to mix with if you prefer a Negroni, Gimlet or Espresso Martini. And beer aficionados can always browse our craft beers, including Hazy Pales. Fascina, your local independent SA family liquor store for over 45 years. 5AA's Tech Talk with your host, Adelaide Tech Guy Richard Pascoe. Thanks to Harvey Norman Computers.
Whether it's the latest Samsung Galaxy S24 or the latest Apple iPhone 15, Harvey Norman has you covered. Head in store to sign up to a new up to $69 a month, 24-month SIM-only plan. And you'll get unlimited calls and texts to standard numbers and 100 gigabytes of data for use in Oz. Plus, you'll receive an $800 Harvey Norman gift card when you sign up. Tell them I sent you and you'll score a further $100 gift card. That's $900 towards your new phone. With a deal this good, there's some fine print. Minimum plan costs $1,656 over 24 months. Maximum of 5 gift cards per account. Re-contracts and rate plan changes excluded. Plan cancellation fees apply. See in store for details.
Check out this great offer at a Harvey Norman store near you.
Up to the minute news for South Australia. This is 5AA News, always Adelaide.
Sunny and 24 with the 7 o'clock news, I'm Kendall Brettig.
Chipped windscreen? Complete windscreens can repair it from just $99. Look for the big red koala.
Labor's Cressida O'Hanlon's almost certain to be Stephen Marshall's successor in the seat of Dunstan following Saturday's by-election. The Liberals' Anna Fenizio may have come away with most of the primary vote, but surging support for the Greens will see the seat switch to Labor on preferences. It's raised speculation about David Spears' future as Liberal leader. While a new opinion poll shows Labor would be pushed into minority government if a federal election was held now. The news poll shows Labor's primary vote sits at a paltry 32%, while the Libs are on 37%. The Albanese government only pushes ahead after preferences, mainly from the Greens. More Australians are struggling to pay their power bills, with an increase in those accessing hardship arrangements. Alex Nimmo has details.
More than 116,000 customers are accessing support to pay their electricity bills. That's a 59% increase since June 2022. Data from the Australian Energy Regulator shows there's also been a 70% increase in those seeking aid to pay gas bills. News Corp reports hardship programs are only available to those in a short-term financial crisis. The Coalition says the number of those facing hardship is unacceptable.
We're being reminded not to leave candles burning unattended in our homes after a house fire at Salisbury East yesterday. The MFS was called to Clayton Road after reports of flames visible through the roof of the home. Sophie Clark from the MFS says no one was home at the time, but one member of the family was rescued.
However, firefighters rescued a dog that was trapped inside the house. Fire investigators have attended and have estimated the structural damage at approximately $500,000.
A firefighter was also treated at the scene for smoke inhalation. New South Wales police have arrested 19 people in relation to a protest at Port Botany. The Palestine Justice Movement and Trade Unionists for Palestine gathered at the port in Sydney's southeast, protesting against the docking of an Israeli ship. The group set up a blockade preventing access to the port. Russian forces are unleashing a barrage of missile attacks on Ukraine after Vladimir Putin tried to blame the country for killing 137 people in a music hall in Moscow. More from US correspondent Alison Petrowski.
Russia has staged major airstrikes on Ukraine overnight, targeting the capital Kyiv as well as Lviv in the west of the country. Polish forces were also placed on high alert after a Russian missile violated their airspace. Poland's foreign ministry says it will demand an explanation from Moscow. US Vice President Kamala Harris has refuted Vladimir Putin's claims that the gunmen responsible for Friday's terror attack are linked to Ukraine.
No, there is no whatsoever any evidence, and in fact what we know to be the case is that ISIS-K is actually, by all accounts, responsible.
Meanwhile, Russia's ambassador to the US said American officials did not pass on concrete information about a potential terrorist attack.
Social media algorithms are letting through harmful content promoting eating disorders online. Advocacy group Reset Australia created 12 fake ads advertising toxic dieting, finding 100% were approved on TikTok. Facebook approved 83% of the ads. Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Colours, custom design, any house, any style. Gliderol Garage Doors, gliderol.com.au.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Port Adelaide is sitting in third spot on the AFL ladder after round two, following an impressive second half comeback, which saw them win by 30 points against Richmond at the MCG. The Power are 2-0 to start the season and will recover today and start preparing for Melbourne on Saturday night. And there were two other games yesterday to wrap up round two, with GWS cementing top spot with a 65-point thumping of West Coast, while the Bulldogs registered their first win with a 48-point win against Gold Coast. Let's go to motorsport. Lando Norris has defended McLaren's order for him to overtake Oscar Piastri during the Australian Formula One Grand Prix. Piastri conceded third place to his teammate, eventually finishing fourth and missing out on a podium finish at his home race. Despite failing to improve the team's position, Norris says it was the right decision.
I was a lot quicker and I would have overtaken him anyway. It's just you don't want to delay the process of that happening, and the longer I kind of spent behind him, the worse it was making my chance of catching Charles and trying to be ahead of Charles. So I don't think the result changed at all. He made my life easier and I think he helped us as a team, which I thank him for a lot.
Carlos Sainz won at Albert Park while Charles Leclerc came second. Well, for a third straight season, Western Australia has taken out the Sheffield Shield final after smashing Tasmania by 377 runs in the final in Perth. And Aussie Alex de Minaur is through to the third round of the Miami Open following a 6-3, 6-2 win against Soon Woo Kwon. And he'll be joined in the round of 32 by Alexei Poprin, who had a 6-4, 6-4 win against Adelaide International winner Yuri Lehechka. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now checking 5AA traffic.
When you cover things, they last longer. Same goes for you. Save your skin. Download the SunSmart app.
At Hackamas Smash on South Road near the Southern Expressway, entry heading inbound. Parafield Gardens collision on the Salisbury Highway near Kings Road, and Elizabeth Burst Watermain Main North Road near Woodford Road, two lanes closed with speeds at 40. Slow going for works at Seacliff Park, Ocean Boulevard near Schofield Road with a camera today, Junction Road at Balhanna. See one of Goodyear Auto Care's tyre experts before you go on a road trip these holidays, and they'll check your tyres and make sure you're good to go. Call 1323 43 to book in. Adelaide's most accurate traffic. Traffic on 5AA.
To the weather, sunny and 24 today, mostly sunny tomorrow, 25, sunny on Wednesday, 26 and 27 for Thursday, at the moment 11. More news as it happens on 5AA.
It's Edward here from Edwardstown Mazda.
Thanks, Edward. I've got this. And it's big news.
How big?
Really big. Edwardstown Mazda have extended their sale with huge Mazda factory bonuses across a wide range of Mazdas. Plus, get a $2,000 trade-in bonus on top of your trade-in price. Only available at Edwardstown Mazda.
Wow!
I know, right? Wow!
Play the jingle sing.
It's gotta be
Edwardstown Mazda. T's and C's apply.
5AA Breakfast is streaming live right now. To watch, simply head to 5AA on Facebook or YouTube.
Two of you joining us for the first time on this Monday morning. It is the 25th of March. Coolish start to the day. The top of 24, as you just heard, is okay, but the real headliners are towards the end of the week as we get towards the Easter long weekend. Good Friday, Easter Saturday. Beautiful days, weather-wise. 31 on the Saturday and 28 on the Sunday. Good Friday, 29 too. So, frankly, the entire Easter long weekend is looking magnificent. Don't have a Monday forecast yet, but we'll keep an eye on that. That'll come out a little bit later tomorrow. Stacey Lee's going to join us after 7:30 today. And, of course, we'll have plenty to say about the Dunstan by-election. But it is the place we also start our news wrap for this hour at 7 o'clock. The state of play hasn't been a whole lot of change yesterday, of course, based on the Electoral Commission rules here in South Australia. They will count pre-polls and postals from today.
I don't know why they do that. I don't know why they can't count them before the election. Is it because that for security reasons? Like for the integrity of the election?
Yeah.
You know, you could have a situation where someone tells someone who tells somebody else, oh, you know, we're at the Electoral Commission last night, and I'll tell you the Libs are in trouble or Labor's in trouble. Mm. Or the Greens are
word gets
on
out.
Fire.
Well, it's impossible for that. That's actually not outlandish. It's impossible for there not to be leaks because there are scrutineers of every vote.
Correct. Yeah.
So a member of each party.
There's party political people.
Yeah, they'd be sitting there going, hey, we're not looking good. We need to, let's spend 50 grand on an ad campaign.
Yeah, or, yeah. Or the Greens vote surging, so let's put out a negative flyer against them or something.
I think that's right. And the other thing is, it's clear now that these laws are outdated and need to change. You can't vote them, but you can't count them on the before the day, obviously. But they need to be counted on the night or into the Sunday. Because we live in a world now where an increasing number of people are voting before elections. Yeah. But this was designed for when it was 5% of people were doing this.
Mm.
Now it's 10-20% of people are voting this way. It's enough to turn the election. Albeit probably won't be enough to change this one. The Liberal primary vote plummeted 46.7% when Stephen Marshall retained the seat at the 2022 election, down to 40%. The Labor vote dropped as well, down 3% to 32.3%. This is first preferences. But if you look at the two-party preferred, the last count had Cressida O'Hanlon at about 53.8% over the Liberals' Anna Finizio. The big winner on the day, in terms of just the raw change from 2022, was Katie McCusker, who we had on Friday morning. The Greens candidate polled 22.4%. of Greens preferences. Nearly one in four voters walked into the booth and put the Greens as their first preference. That is up almost 9%.
There were some unique features to this by-election, but obviously there were a lot of people, myself included, put my hand up here, who wrongly predicted that the Green vote would go down. We saw it go down in Dunkley.
Yep.
Clearly, the unpopularity of Scott Morrison with small Liberal voters, women voters, was a huge issue in driving up the Green vote at the last election, where a lot of people didn't want to go over to voting Labor, but they wanted to send the Liberals a message. So you had a lot of middle-class, uni-educated voters in seats like Dunstan who went to the Greens for that reason. Well, this result shows that the Greens are still very much a force to be reckoned with, despite the fact that two things, I think, really did fuel their vote in Dunstan. One was the appalling and relentless negativity of both the Labor and Liberal parties in defaming, denouncing, slinging mud at their rival candidates, both Cressida O'Hanlon and Anna Finizio. The second was Sarah Hanson-Young's really powerful use of the Alex Antic drama, with him rolling the state's most senior female Liberal. Sarah Hanson-Young wrote to every single household in Dunstan an open letter to the women of Dunstan saying the Liberal Party has a problem with women. And they gave her plenty of ammo to prosecute that argument. And whether the conservative Liberals who think, no, we are allowed to, we are a meritocracy and we'll vote for whoever we like, well, you can do that, but you're going to lose a lot of women voters in the process. And I reckon that's exactly what happened on Saturday.
If you're a Liberal that's a Jim Carrey-esque, Dumb and Dumber-style optimist, so you're saying there's a chance, the Libs would need 56.5% on pre-polls and postals. The closest approximation to that kind of thing you can get is the Bragg by-election that was about 50.5% on the night, and Jack Batty ended up winning by a margin of 56.5%. So it jumped significantly on pre-polls and postals, but that wouldn't be enough. So something amazing would need to happen. It now invites a lot of speculation about the future of Liberal leader David Spears and whether there'll be a move. That's the trendy thing to think now, obviously.
I don't think in the short term that there will be a challenge. I don't think Vincent Tarsi has got the numbers to do anything other than embarrass himself if he does run.
I've heard the exact same thing. Yep.
You know, I reckon the only thing that can stop David Spears from being leader right now is David Spears. And part of me wonders whether he might just wake up one morning and go, what am I doing this for? Because he's got the most thankless job in South Australia.
Yep.
I mean, you know, to quote Jay Weatherill, he's up against a candidate in Malinowskis who looks like he was designed in a laboratory. You know, a uniquely popular guy who's still, despite their ramping dramas, you know, people looked and go, you know, things are going well.
Mm.
State's got a bit of vim and vigour and energy and, you know, we've got lowest unemployment rate in the country. Well, I just think that you can't imagine a worse time in the history of the state to be the opposition leader.
Yeah, who would anyone genuinely want it at the moment? Lead the party to an almost guaranteed loss at the next election?
I don't think anyone would want it. Ashton Hearn doesn't want to do it.
Well, she's got bigger fish to fry at the moment, doesn't
she?
Yeah,
totally.
She's got a
bub on the way.
A baby on the way. I mean, she's the obvious heir apparent, isn't she?
Yeah, but even
everything else feels like
she's only been in for 2 years.
But she's a very effective communicator. Actually, yeah. I think the best argument for David Spears is anyone screaming out talent-wise that would be a huge upgrade on him? I don't think so.
No.
I think long-term, she obviously is, because she's got a huge political talent and is an excellent communicator, has the right sort of vim and vigour for the fight. But
all I know is David Spears will be happy this morning that he's woken up, you know, stone's throw away from Shido Park, as opposed to Beulah Park, where everyone's agitated about urban infill. Funny, the sort of sense of what... You can live in a seat like Dunstan and you can feel under siege from something.
Yeah, people. Other people. The biggest issue is other people being around.
It's the most pampered state electorate.
we learn a lot about it.
What about some of the suburbs, though? So, Joslin, Kensington... Joslin and Kensington... Two-party preferred, they voted Labor. I don't think that's ever happened in the history of those two suburbs.
Yeah, well, it all makes Peter Malinauskas pretty happy, I think. Here he is speaking on Nine News over the weekend.
The only reason why we're in a position to defy 116 years of history isn't because of one individual effort, it's because of a genuine team effort. Well, David Spears has been doing plenty of media ops in the lead-up to the by-election. I'm sure in due course he will answer some questions. To have a swing to us at a by-election is probably not something most people anticipated. It's unusual.
Yeah, well,
so it is a big story. We'll have more on that with Stacey Lee after 7:30. It's the biggest story in politics right now, albeit there is another one overnight, because we had a news poll that came out, and the federal two-party preferred is suddenly on a knife edge, 51-49. The LNP's gained a point, Labor's lost a point by that measure. All the preferred premium stuff basically was unmoved. The Labor federal primary vote down to 32%, the Libs up to 37%, the Greens gained a point, and so too did One Nation. It won't be enough. Right now, this is not enough to suggest there's the potential of a change of government, but it might mean minority government. It might mean it's going to be tighter than anyone expected.
Hmm. These days, you've just got to count the Green vote as part of the Labor vote, though.
And absolutely.
Saturday showed that.
Absolutely.
You know, the flow of preferences is so tight that the Greens, even though Labor passionately disagrees with a lot of their policies, the Greens are the best thing Labor's got going for them. Because, like Saturday showed, Labor's primary vote can fall, but as long as the Libs falls more, there's no way Labor's going to lose. Because when you've got the Greens polling as well as they did on Saturday, that's going to get them over the line every time. The most first-past-the-post votes anybody got on Saturday was the Liberal candidate.
40%.
Yeah, but... Doesn't help her at all.
Yet in Tasmania, Labor and the Greens aren't going to create a coalition to form government there.
Yeah, oh, that parliament, though. You send yourself mad trying to work out what's going on there. Because there's Jackie Lambie MPs, there's other independent MPs. They put a circus tent over that place.
It is entirely bizarre. Speaking of circuses, well, maybe not circuses, but shows, Glenn in Hawthorne's called in on the Mount Barker show. Glenn, good morning to you.
Good morning, guys. I'm not actually at home at the moment. I'm on the Outer Harbour train to go and have a look at a ship. My car broke down on the way, so you have to bear with me.
What ship are you going to see, Glenn?
I'm not quite sure what's in, but it'll be a big one, I gather.
Okay.
So we'll see what happens. But look, country shows, I reckon, the people there, I reckon they are the souls of our earth, country people. They're just wonderful people. And we had they had a band there, the country band. They were doing boot scooting and...
this is up at Mount Barker, Glenn.
Yeah, hang on. And they had the guy there with Cool for Kids, the guy like Peter Coombs.
Newspaper mama.
And I'll tell you what, they don't have normal seats to sit on. You sit on a bale of hay and without needles in them. And it's absolutely fantastic, ollical. $5 to get in. There were 5,000 people there. It was absolutely brilliant. I got to have a look at my old ambulances I used to drive with Dr. Bill Griggs from Hindmarsh 100 years ago and Richard Coons from State Emergency Services. The old M-cares, and the old three-door panel van, and the old Ford F-100. They had the classic and vintage wrecking cars there. It was just absolutely awesome.
Well, it sounds like one hell of a day out, Glenn. Good stuff, thanks for sharing it.
Glad you had a good time. Mount Barker show.
Apropos of nothing.
That's all right.
But it was a bit of fun.
There's things on around Adelaide people have had a good time at.
Why not?
Spread the love around.
Absolutely. Good on you, Glenn.
And have a good day going out to Outer Harbour too.
Always love Glenn's calls.
Exactly right. 19 after 7.
Let's never know what he's been up to.
It's nice to know what's going on around
passionate
town,
South Australian.
Exactly right. Let's check traffic. When the UV's 3 and above, cover up your sun protection. Stay sun smart. Download the Sun Smart app.
Thanks, Will. At Hackham, a smash in South Road near the Southern Expressway entry heading inbound. At Elizabeth, a burst water main North Road near Woodford Road. Two lanes closed at speeds at 40. And Prospect, urgent electrical works, 22 Road near Olive Street, speeds at 40 there too. Works at Seacliff Park, Ocean Boulevard near Schofield Road. I've got a camera today, Alexandrina Road at Mount Barker. Relax, Freedom's got bedrooms covered. Save up to 50% off Freedom mattresses and up to 25% off selected bedroom furniture. Sale ends Wednesday only at Freedom. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
5AA Mornings with Matthew Pantelis.
Billions of dollars have been given to a UK company as part of the AUKUS deal. Premier Peter Malinauskas on the line. It really is happening now with this deal in place, isn't it?
It's a massive day, Matthew, and one that I think there's a lot of people quite rightly enthusiastic about. It's a really important opportunity for our state.
Matthew Pantelis.
We're going to be building the most complex machine ever constructed in human history.
Weekday mornings from 9 on 5AA. Always Adelaide.
Wolko, Blanky! Wolko! Blanky! Wolko! Blanky! This is a game Pool and I play. Each night I come out and put her Wolko! Blanky on. Keeps her from evaporating. But winter is coming. Soon she'll need her Wolko Guardian pool cover. Sure, the fun ends, but I know she's looked after. Chemicals sealed off from the light, water clean, and no need for your pump. Get your pool a Wolko Guardian pool cover for winter. Wolko.com.au.
Get obsessed with the Honda SUV range at Formula Honda, Modbury and Glen Osmond. Whether it's the compact HR-V, the sporty mid-sized Honda ZR-V, or the spacious CR-V. And for a limited time, new Honda SUVs come with a 7-year warranty, 7-year roadside assist, and 5 standard low-price services at $199 each. Visit Formula Honda, Modbury or Glen Osmond and test drive today. Vehicles used for a commercial purpose have a 7-year or 200,000-kilometre warranty, whichever occurs first. T's and C's at honda.com.au.
After 25 years of delivering perfect service, ASIC Couriers is evolving to better reflect what they do now, because they're not just couriers anymore.
I bumped into the ASIC guys Friday night at the football. They're having about as good a time as the rest of us Crows supporters at that game. Probably happy that they're back at work today doing what they do, which is to provide a brilliant courier service. ASIC Couriers, they're your go-to for fast, secure and reliable national transport solutions. So they're now known as ASIC Transport Solutions.
Darren, Chris and the team at ASIC Transport Solutions now have a fleet of over 220 vehicles delivering any size parcel and any size pallet to anywhere in Australia.
But they are still a local family business supporting more than 25 sporting clubs in SA.
Book online in 3 simple steps at asiccouriers.com.au. Don't send it, ace it.
Over 60,000 Adelaide homes have said yes to saving money on their energy bills with Yes, Your Energy Saving Solutions. What's keeping you? Did you know that you might be eligible for a rebate on a new appliance like a dryer or fridge? You might even qualify for a purchase you've already made. Just visit the Yes website for a list of appliances and the size of the cashback available. For T's and C's on this unbeatable offer from Your Energy Saving Solutions, go to yes.net.au. That's yes.net.au.
Rosanna Mangiarelli here from 7 News. Join me and Will Goodings for Adelaide's leading news hour, 7 News, tonight at 6 o'clock.
Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on, touch base, search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings, 5AA Breakfast.
Twenty-three minutes after 7, Stacey Lee not too far away. Jeff Brock after 8:30, and a big breaking at 8 today as well. It's the moment you've all been waiting for, Port fans.
Port fans,
yeah,
Port fans.
I say that pointedly.
Stephen Lowe on 5AA Breakfast.
Good boy.
Weren't a lot of good boys on Friday night. $19 schnitty Monday to Wednesday at the Birkenhead Tavern, Excelsior and Lighthouse Wharf. You just know it's a Barrow Hotel. Morning to you, Rowie.
Oh, Pebo and Will, good morning. I'll quickly start with Port. They were clinical in their 30-point win over Richmond. I think they've got all three aspects of their game going, and a nice way to honour Boakey's 350th. A little bit of a favourite of mine, as I was with him out at Glenelg when he first came over as a pimply little-headed cardigan-wearing boy from Torquay. I think the only question for him is, can he push on to 400 or will he do a flag and retire? So they were pretty good yesterday, weren't they?
Yeah, they were. The second quarter was they were ordinary, but after that, the game was never really in doubt. They're a class above Richmond. Special shout out to the Richmond fans for the ovation they gave Boak late in the game as well. Thought it was really classy.
Nah, well done, well done. I wonder whether they'll fixture a AFL game at the MCG when the Grand Prix's on again.
Wasn't
Is that
a great
the smallest crowd,
crowd was it?
For Richmond in the history of the last 10 years?
It looked awful,
didn't it?
It looked awful. Yeah.
Okay.
But speaking of awful.
Yeah, you're right. Have you got me? I've just dropped out.
No, we got we've got you.
Oh, sorry about that. Yeah. Well, yeah, you're right. The Crows sadly haven't got any of their aspects of the game going. Like last week, you just cannot. The only word I could come up with last week and now this week is the word dumb. You can't be that dumb about how you play. They had more disposals, plus 23, more inside 50s, plus 13. They had 66, by the way. They had more free kicks. They won the hit-outs, the clearances, the centre square, the ground ball, the loose ball, the contested ball. They won every bloody ball, but they kicked it straight to Stewart. Now, who, by the way, they had two or three plans for, supposedly. I know the peddler one started. I was happy with that at the start. In hindsight, it didn't work. And I think the stat was Geelong had 19 defensive 50 marks. So you two are smart. You're good with your words. Give me another word other than dumb football to describe that on the weekend.
Well, this is not one word. It's a few. But it looked like nothing was linking up. Like all all those forward 50s you describe, almost all of them felt like they were actual deliberate passes to the Geelong defence. It was just crazy.
Yeah.
But don't you reckon? Do you think, Riley, that we need to get beyond? You know, I know Nixie's like the world's most reasonable guy, but crikey, like this sort of post match glass half full, glass half empty. There are some moments where not only is this glass empty, there's no bloody glass. Like it, you need to get a bit David Parkin, I reckon, on some of these players because. Some of what they served up, including the fog. I mean, God bless him, but I reckon any of our listeners could have kicked that goal. Like, what the hell was going on there?
Yeah, I know exactly what you're saying. Get that vein out in your neck. I don't think he's got that in his makeup or character. I'm going to be pragmatic, balanced and reserved. Three things I'm never, okay? It's round two.
Now I'm really worried.
We're 0-2.
Have you been body swapped, mate? What's going on?
Yeah.
Somehow this makes me feel
here's
worse.
The thing. No, but here's the thing. And
Stephen Rowe calls for calm.
Here's the thing, right? We can win the footy. We can win it. Those numbers against Geelong, we can win that ball. We've certainly got the fight. I think we've got the talent and the system. And look, we've shown that last year. So this, for me, is a coach's problem. Over to you, coaches. And I mentioned this back in November. James Raleigh was the ball movement king. Our ball movement last year, our inside 50 connection, our conversion and scoring numbers in 2023, number one. That is fact. Here's the thing for me. Scotty Burns, it's not all on him. It's on Nixie. He's the senior coach. He's a bit negative. And every player we spoke to, we've got to be better at defence. We've got to be better at defending turnovers. We've got to be better locking the ball inside 50. Defence, 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 defence. This team's playing timid, cautious. I call it flaccid footy.
Mm.
They need to put some lead in their pencils. You know what I mean? Mm. And I'm trying to be as nice as I can about that.
Mm.
Let them play. Let them play their DNA and tweak from there. Otherwise, what do you got? Frio away, Melbourne home, Carlton away. If we're 0-5, I will not be pragmatic. I will not be balanced. I will swing from the rafters, and I'll be taking as many out as I can.
Yeah. Hopefully it doesn't get to that,
Rowie. Let's hope we never hear that one. Good on you, Rowie.
Fair call.
I got a feeling we might.
The only good, the only positive thing you can say about the Crows after two rounds, if you're going to fail badly, fail early.
Mm.
Like, yeah. If your worst two rounds are your first two rounds,
yeah, we get all the losses out of the way at the start.
Gives you some time to correct some incorrect assumptions you may have dragged out of pre-season. More on the sports show tonight. It's going to be a fascinating listen with Rowie and Timmy G. $19 schnitty Monday to Wednesday at the Birkenhead Tavern, Excelsior Lighthouse Wharf. You just know it's a Borough Hotel.
Keen Office Furniture and Keen Education Furniture have the latest in office and education furniture all in one showroom. And the Keen staff love furniture. So whilst your colleagues talk politics at the water cooler, the Keen team discuss full office fit outs and ergonomic chairs. Except last week when Jackie asked Shane if he used to ride a horse to school before the tram came into operation in 1929. Nice one, Jackie. Keen delivers and sets up furniture at schools and workplaces in Glenelg and all over SA. Keen Office Furniture and Keen Education Furniture. Leaders in office and education furniture.
Now, it's always handy to have a mate with a bus, a van, a truck or a ute, but they rarely have all three or four and can't promise five-star service. That's why Avis Truck Rental Adelaide is the best mate you can have.
They've been SA's go-to vehicle rental company for decades, helping work go smooth and holidays go ahead. So whether you need a bigger set of wheels to get the job done or just to get away, they have you covered.
And with their fleet of vans, buses, utes and trucks you can drive with a car licence, they're sure to help you turn got a problem into not a problem.
Avis Truck Rental Adelaide opens 7 days at 416 Port Road, West Hindmarsh. Book online at avis.com.au or call 8241 5200.
This is 5AA News, always Adelaide.
Sunny in 24 with the 7:30 news, I'm Kendall Brettig.
From chips to replacements, make Complete Windscreens your insurer repairer of choice. CompleteWindscreens.com.au.
A drunk driver's been caught nearly six times over the limit at Malala. Patrol stopped the man around 10 last night for a random breath test. The 55-year-old from Paralawi allegedly blew 0.292. He's lost his licence for 12 months and will face court at a later date. And a car's been clocked doing 150k's in a 100 zone at Roseworthy last night. A short time later, it was spotted at Freeling. Senior Constable Jen Cullinan says the 44-year-old driver's been charged with numerous offences,
including excess speed, speed dangerous, no licence, hinder and breach of bail, and he's got himself a date with the magistrate this morning.
Labor is set to snatch an historic win in former Premier Stephen Marshall's old seat of Dunstan. With vote counting not yet complete, Labor's Cressida O'Hanlon's tipped to win on preferences. It'll put more pressure on Liberal leader David Spears. While the Greens have been buoyed by their strong showing, they're now eyeing the seat of Sturt at the next federal election. And the latest news poll has seen the federal government's primary vote slip to 32%, while the coalition's lifted a point to 37. Anthony Albanese has moved ahead as preferred prime minister, though. The federal government's pushing for a pay increase for the nation's lowest paid workers. Labor will make its submission to the Fair Work Commission on Thursday, arguing this year's minimum wage increase should match inflation. But Shadow Finance Minister Jane Hume says the government should focus on bringing down consumer costs instead.
The RBA are telling us that they're not expecting inflation to come back to band now until the end of 2025 and probably not to its target until 2026. Now that's cold comfort for those people on minimum wages that are doing it tough.
Research shows grade inflation is becoming more prevalent at universities around the country. Alex Nimmo reports.
Experts are warning the integrity of university degrees is at risk as more students are being awarded high distinctions. Research conducted by the University of Sydney shows a 234% increase in those who received top marks between 2011 and 2021. Some academics say students are becoming more anxious and are increasingly likely to pester markers for higher grades. A senior lecturer has told SMH The Age it's becoming harder to distinguish between high-ranking students.
Postal workers have reported more than 81,000 hazards in the past 18 months, an average of over 200 per day. The Australia Post data reveals dogs are the most common hazard for posties, followed by low-hanging branches and obstructive trees. Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Gliderol Garage Doors, adding strength, style and safety to your home. Gliderol.com.au.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Going to start with some football. Port Adelaide coach Ken Hinckley has praised the work of his midfield group following the Power's 30-point win against Richmond at the MCG. The Power trailed by 11 points at halftime, but came back with 13 goals to 6 in the second half, and Hinckley says his midfield group got going.
That group of midfielders, they all play well. Zach was great again, outstanding. Connor, Ollie, look, Willem Drew played a pretty big part in the second half for us. It was important for us too. And then our forwards got some battles done, which we were getting beaten pretty badly in the first half, or particularly the second quarter.
Well, Carlos Sainz has won the Australian Formula One Grand Prix at Albert Park ahead of teammate Charles Leclerc. Australian Oscar Piastri finishing fourth, while Max Verstappen and Lewis Hamilton failed to complete the race with car troubles. After starting near the back of the grid, Daniel Ricciardo finished 12th and says there were some positives.
Yeah, obviously, when you don't get in the points, you feel like, oh, but I think there was moments in the race where I had a bit of a clear track and I was able to use my speed once I think I got past Ocon. It's nice to be racing at home. I just would have loved to have obviously been a bit further up there.
And a buzzer beater from Jack McVeigh has seen the Tassie Jack Jumpers beat Melbourne United 93-91 in Game 3 of the NBL Grand Final Championship Series. Tassie now leads the best of five series 2-1. And that's the 5AA sport.
Now checking 5AA traffic.
When you cover things, they last longer. Same goes for you. Save your skin. Download the SunSmart app.
And how come look out for a smash this morning? South Road into Southern Expressway entry. Really heavy delays inbound at the moment. Also delays at Elizabeth, Burstwater Main North Road near Woodford Road. And got cameras today. Swanport Road, Murray Bridge and Wellington Road at Mount Barker. School's nearly out and adventures are in at Discovery Parks with year-round experiences for the whole family. Get in quick to secure your holiday booking at Discovery Parks. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Now onto the weather. Sunny and 24 today, mostly sunny tomorrow, 25, sunny on Wednesday, 26 and 27 for Thursday. At the moment, 11. More news as it happens on 5AA.
5AA's Tech Talk with your host, Adelaide Tech Guy Richard Pascoe. Thanks to Harvey Norman Computers.
Whether it's the latest Samsung Galaxy S24 or the latest Apple iPhone 15, Harvey Norman has you covered. Head in store to sign up to a new up to $69 a month, 24-month SIM-only plan. And you'll get unlimited calls and texts to standard numbers and 100 gigabytes of data for use in Oz. Plus, you'll receive an $800 Harvey Norman gift card when you sign up. Tell them I sent you and you'll score a further $100 gift card. That's $900 towards your new phone. With a deal this good, there's some fine print. Minimum plan costs $1,656 over 24 months. Maximum of 5 gift cards per account. Recontracts and rate plan changes excluded. Plan cancellation fees apply. See in store for details.
Check out this great offer at a Harvey Norman store near you. Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on. Touch base. Search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings. 5AA Breakfast.
23 minutes to 8. Have you ever absent-mindedly put something on the roof of the car and then driven off?
Yes, and I'll tell you what it was. It was a six-pack of Cooper's Pale Ale.
Did it survive the journey?
When I was living in Sydney, I was at the intersection of Broadway and King Street near Newtown, and this guy next to me is going, mate, mate, mate. And I'm looking at him and go, what, what? And he's going, your roof, your roof. The six-pack, is there anything Cooper's Pale Ale can't do? It was still there on the roof of my bright red Commodore station wagon.
I've done it twice since we had Rosie, where I put her in the car.
And what are you going to say here?
No, not Cooper's Pale. I put the keys on the roof as she gets put in the baby seat, and I've done it twice and driven from our place to Westlakes Mall.
And the keys were still there.
Parked, and the keys have still been on top. I don't understand how that. I don't know enough about physics to know what's possible. The reason
I thought
up,
you were going to say that you got Rosie out of the capsule, put her in on the baby roof. Seat, and then put the capsule on the roof.
Yeah, no, I haven't done that one yet. No, not yet. The reason we ask is because of Lyndall Kane, who her and her partner had the very happy duty of being going to get their wedding dress or her wedding dress. They put the box on top of the car, and on the way home, it flew off. They've offered a $500 reward to see if it can get found. We're going to be hearing from Lyndall Kane this half hour. That's coming up on 5AA Breakfast, not too far away. First, though,
This is going to be a lot of fun. Keen Office Furniture and Keen Education Furniture leading the way in office and education furniture right here in SA. It's been all built up to this point, but now it's the fallout. Stacey Lee joins us in the studio to talk about the by-election that was. Stacey, good morning to you.
Good morning. I don't even know where to start.
It's pretty amazing, isn't it? First time isn't in 116 it? Years that a government's won a by-election winning a seat off an opposition. Extraordinary result.
That Greens figure, though.
Mm.
That Greens number astounds me. I think I was expecting a bit of a swing towards the Greens, but not that much.
What do you put it down to?
I was totally wrong.
I think it's a protest vote.
Yeah.
And I think if there was a Teal candidate, that Greens figure would not be that high.
Mm.
And I think a Teal could be very close to getting over the line if there's a Teal candidate at the next state election. I think this is a like a bit of a rally.
Well, and for federal the election to too.
Mm-hmm. Sturt.
That's what we're going to be looking at today after 8 o'clock. It's yep. ominous, isn't it? And this is where it's a microcosm of the problem the Libs have got around the country, where the middle class, like affluent Australia, used to be the bedrock of support for the Liberal Party.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because of climate change, gender issues, all these different things, the challenge for the Libs is they've got to win suburbia to make up for losing the bourgeoisie.
Yeah, but you say gender issues, and does anyone out there actually care about gender issues until they're asked about gender issues?
Well,
I mean, when you
that
are
was a traditional Liberal voter, especially too.
Well, when yeah. you are talking mm. to people in Norwood or wherever, Elizabeth, Hallett Cove, Fullerton, wherever you are, does anyone bring up a gender issue until you bring it up to them? I've never had anyone want to talk about.
No one mentioned it when Jay did Voxies in Dunstan. All Friday mornings was there for 3 hours. Urban infill was the thing that came up most yeah. often, which I think has been borne out in the result.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And but don't you reckon, though, with Hanson Young seizing on that last week yeah. and saying the Libs have got a women problem, that it just became another black mark against their name in the minds of some voters?
Yeah. Yeah. And you know what? I think that was really smart politics. And there are some Liberals who are furious at Sarah Hanson Young for that. And, you know, fine, as they could and should be.
All's fair in love and war.
Yeah, absolutely. That's politics. But it's true. Everything she said is true, that the Liberal Party does have a women's problem and they're not addressing it.
Well, you know, we don't take this person seriously enough as a political figure, I think, but we should. The person who, on the right of politics in the world, who has best navigated the issue of rich inner-city suburbanites suddenly shifting left and having to engage suburban working-class people has been Donald Trump.
Correct.
Donald Trump is the best person in the world who's navigated the problem that currently faces the Liberal Party in Australia. I don't know what you do with that information, but I think...
Well, I'll tell you what you do. If you're Alex Antic, you knock off Ian Rustin.
That, well,
because
yes.
that's the right's view is we... And look, the best thing they've got going for them, I think, when they're trying to make this point... And you prosecuted this story brilliantly on your show, Stace, was Anna Fenizio, a few years ago, she was trying to join the Labor Party, which was trying to work for a Labor government. She's trying to work for the Labor Attorney General.
Mm.
That suggests a degree of Tweedledum, Tweedledee in her politics, does it not?
Yeah.
So maybe you actually need candidates who are demonstrably providing an alternative as opposed to forum shoppers who look like, you know, they could...
Mm.
And the other reason too, the Dunstan fell to Labor is because Stephen Marshall turned it into a marginal seat.
I don't know. I have to say I disagree with both of you on that. Imagine the Liberal Party going further to the right. Then there will be a Teal candidate and the Teals will win all of those inner city seats, or we will have a Labor government in South Australia for the next 30 years. I mean, it was almost 20 when Jay Weatherill finished, but can you imagine the Liberal Party in South Australia going more to the right? They've only got 14 seats. Labor has doubled their seat, 28 to 14.
I'm not advocating it, but that is their argument. I think
that's the anti-J argument.
But the only successful Liberal leader so far in the last 20 years has been Stephen Marshall. Any conservative Liberals actually
been successful? Yeah, I think it's a better argument to make if you transpose it over the map of the no vote for the referendum nationally. I don't know if it holds in South Australia.
See, the problem is the Liberals have forgotten their own history. And this is where this sort of left-right fight of the death is going to get them nowhere.
Exactly.
The person who actually mastered it and is the model, the exemplar, and he's probably being copied more now by smart Labor centrists like Malinowskis, is John Howard.
Mm.
John Howard had Amanda Vanstone and Robert Hill from the left in cabinet, alongside Nick Minchin, Alexander Downer. He had huge respect for people like the moderate, long-serving member for Adelaide, Trish Worth. He made Trish a parliamentary secretary. He used to talk to people like Trish Worth and Chris Gallus, who was the moderate female member for Hindmarsh during the Howard years. Howard was the guy who mastered the term, or who coined the term, the broad church. Mm. Now it's like they're trying to rip the pews out of the church. Mm. No one's allowed to sit there. You know, it's a fight to the death. And it we is. Saw their death on Saturday.
It is, and it will continue now because Vincent Tarzi is not answering calls. He's calling around. I don't think, I was listening to you guys earlier, I don't think there will be a challenge, and if there is, it will be the death of the Liberal Party here. Because can you, if Vincent Tarzia actually challenges David Spears, I can see Spears just going, all right, I'm done, you guys have it, you guys have it. And then what? And then Vincent Tarzia will be an interim leader until the next election. There'll have to be a by-election in David Spears' seat of Black, which is a suburban seat, which will probably go back to Labor after so many years of being Labor before Spears took it over. And voters will hate the Liberal Party because they've made them have by-elections in Bragg, Dunstan, Black, all in one term.
The other problem too is, you know, with all the independents holding what should be Liberal seats, numerically, like, you just don't see any way back for them in the medium term, do you?
No. And who will be the deputy as well? I'm just thinking, all right, if we are doing this, if the Liberal Party is doing this...
If Vincent Tarzia is the leader.
If Vincent Tarzia is going to challenge, who is going to be his deputy? Because you can't have two moderates.
Yeah, John Gardner being the current deputy.
But there are no Conservatives left. There are no... Because, as you pointed to, Dave, they are all independents now for various reasons.
Might be a way to get one back in the tent.
It's for varied reasons, but mostly of their own doing.
So you're as plugged in as anyone in this town, Stacey. You're saying this week you don't think there'll be a leadership challenge.
Well, there can't be. There absolutely can't be. And if there is, they're dead.
Mm. Gary's called in. He wants to have a chat with you, Stace. Gary, good morning.
Yeah, good morning, guys. A couple of things that you've just mentioned. I don't necessarily agree that Trump has bought the left cross. The problem with Trump, in my opinion, is that he's bought the extremists, be it the extreme left or the extreme right. That's the group that he's galvanised. With regard to Dunstan, it's an absolute debacle. I agree we shouldn't have a leadership challenge, but I think Spears needs to just step down. I think not bringing Marshall into the electorate, it was just an absolute debacle, and with an inept leader like Spears, we have no hope. They need to start rebuilding, otherwise we're going to be destined to a generation in opposition.
Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you, Gary. I don't think wouldn't be a lot of disagreement, I suspect, coming through on that.
I want to read out Scott's text on the Dutton's text line about the Green vote. He says, it's not a protest vote, you fools. There's not one party listening to under 30s except the Greens and Teals at the moment. They're the newest, biggest voting group, bigger than the Boomers, and they're completely priced out of housing at the moment. Hex is out of control. Labor and Liberal can keep ignoring them at their peril.
Mm-hmm. And this is where I think the Liberal Party is at odds with the rest of the population, because, as I say, there's been this push to sign up members who are Pentecostal voters and maybe older men, and they're just not representative of the rest of the community. So, you know, you'll be talking about Sturt soon. We also have Unley, which will be hugely up for grabs.
Well, if this... I reckon Labor wins Unley at the moment.
Mm.
Labor?
Yep.
Yeah.
Labor wins Unley, I think, perversely, comfortably. You know, the only place that voted yes to the seat of Unley overwhelmingly voted yes to the voice to Parliament, and the biggest yes vote cast in South Australia was at Goodwood Primary School.
Mm.
You know, there's a bit of a sort of People's Republic of Goodwood vibe there.
Mm.
And David Pisoni...
What was the Greens number there last time?
I can't recall.
It was quite high because they were really confident afterwards. I remember talking to Tammy Franks about it afterwards. It was surprisingly high. Well, for me. Maybe not so much for Tammy Franks.
But it's the middle class. It's the same people doing the shopping, you know, going out to find an organic cauliflower on the parade. It's the same profile.
But then when you think of the other surrounding seats, Hyson, Morialta. I know the Greens are getting confident about Morialta now as well.
It always felt like Hyson is in inevitability at some point in time.
Yep.
Hmm.
And then Dan Cregan's seat is obviously independently held now, and I don't see that going back to the Libs either.
Nah, because once you go independent, like you look at And he's buddied up with Rebecca Sharkey, who's like a cult figure.
He's on a good thing now. Yeah, he'll be a fixture. Given all that, Stacey, who are we putting on the Keen Office Furniture hot seat this morning?
The Keen Office Furniture hot seat this week is Vincent Tarzia.
Mm. Declare your intentions, Vincent.
Come on, Tarzia. If you're doing it, do it now.
Show your hair.
And let's get it over with.
Yep.
Yeah, he might put out a schmick Instagram video this morning of him sipping a latte walking through Parliament House.
There was a very carefully worded tweet, which, you know,
oh, yeah,
looked quite, we will listen to the people, we must take their guidance, or, you know, we must listen to what they want.
All right, start, Vincent, you're on the hot seat, so you need to act, my friend. Keen Office Furniture and Keen Education Furniture, leading the way in office and education furniture right here in South Australia. Great analysis, Stacey.
On your stage.
More of it, no doubt, this afternoon on the program, which we're very much looking forward to. All right, we're going to check traffic and come back with more, including some of your stories of things you've left on the car roof. In just a moment, we might give away a $100 unique Homestyles food voucher for someone who calls in with one of those stories. Actually, let's do that. 8223 0000 is our number. Traffic first. When the UV's 3 and above, cover up your sun protection. Stay sun smart. Download the Sun Smart app.
At Hackamas Smash and South Road near Southern Expressway, entry heading inbound. At Elizabeth Burst Water Main North Road near Woodford Road with two lanes closed. Speeds at 40 and urgent electrical works this morning at Prospect Churchill Road near Olive Street. You find cameras at Chunga Road at Chunga and Balhanna Road at Harndorf. Hot flight deals have landed at Flight Centre. Fly Adelaide to Los Angeles return from $1,691. Hurry, ends Wednesday. Book in store or online today. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Walko, Blanky! Walko, Blanky! Walko, Blanky! This is a game Pool and I play. Each night I come out and put her Walko, Blanky on. Keeps her from evaporating. But winter is coming. Soon she'll need her Walco Guardian pool cover. Sure, the fun ends, but I know she's looked after. Chemical sealed off from the light, water clean, and no need for your pump. Get your pool a Walco Guardian pool cover for winter. Walco.com.au.
If you need to fix your pipes, call Precise.
Call Precise.
If your toilet's clogging up, call Precise.
Call Precise.
If your lights aren't turning on, or your hot water is gone, or a plumber or an electrician, call Precise.
Precise.
Precise Plumbing and Electrical. Call 1300 700 200. That's 1300 700 200. Precise Plumbing and Electrical. Local and experienced trade specialists.
Or a plumber or an electrician, call Precise.
Call Precise.
The swear jar is back at Bowen Bathrooms and Kitchens. In fact, it never went away, and it is larger than ever. Now it is a swear keg.
No, they're not potty mouths, though. They are people who do what they promise to do. That's because this swear jar, the Biurban swear jar, is completely different. It's full of pledges and promises.
For example, here's one sent to us straight from the Biurban swear jar. It's from Martin the Tyler, affectionately known as Millimeter Martin. Now, he swears you'll love his Millimeter Perfect craftsmanship, and if you've seen his work, you'll know what he means. It is impeccable.
And here's another one from Rick the Plumber, just in. Rick swears to always clean up after himself. Guaranteed. Thank you, Rick. I'm sure that our listeners will hold you to that promise.
For a team that swears to deliver on quality and service, see Biurban Bathrooms and Kitchens, Adelaide's home renovation experts.
Are painful muscle cramps ruining your workout or waking you up at night? If you're low on magnesium, you can get painful muscle cramps or mild muscle spasms. Caruso's vitamin K2 plus D3 plus magnesium contains six types of magnesium in a time-release formula to reduce and relieve muscle cramps when your dietary intake is inadequate. It also supports bone strength, muscle function and heart health. Caruso's vitamin K2 plus D3 plus magnesium is available from leading pharmacies and health stores. Always read the label and follow the directions for use.
Just send it. If your current job is driving you bonkers, get outdoors and hit the road. ACET Transport Solutions is growing and they need more drivers to keep their promise of perfect service. So if you want a career that'll take you places, get in touch with the team at ACET Transport Solutions. Visit acettransport.au.
Don't just send it.
5AA Breakfast is streaming live right now. To watch, simply head to 5AA on Facebook or YouTube. Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on, touch base, search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings. 5AA Breakfast.
728. We're going to catch up with Jade Robrin shortly. He's out on the road speaking with poor old I shouldn't laugh. Lyndall Kane, I only do so because I've done this myself, but not as dramatically, who left her wedding dress on the roof of the car in the box and it fell off as they were driving along Port Wakefield Road towards the city around 9 a.m. So we're asking you this morning, what have you left on the car roof for the $100 unique homestyle food voucher?
Fell off the roof like a bride's nightie.
I'm not sure if they're ready to make jokes about it.
No.
Frank and Athelstan, good morning. What have you left on the roof?
Look, my mum made 16 large pizzas for my nephew's birthday party. So I got to my sister-in-law's place, and I was checking the front seat, the back seat. Did I put it in the boot?
Oh, man.
Oh, maybe I didn't put them in the car at all. So on the way home along Montague Road, got it all splattered along the road.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Could you save any of them, Frank?
There's none at all.
Oh, God, mate. Frank, thank you. Justin, what did you leave on the roof?
Well, you know how you have cats and they mooch on the roof of your car when you take off from home?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, I took off one day down the road and I was going down a whole lot of back streets and all those people were staring at the top of my car. And each time I came to a sort of a cross street, I'd slow down. And eventually I came to one street and my cat came sliding down the windscreen of my car.
Oh, no.
You know, feet first.
No,
I'm not kidding.
Oh,
yeah, poor bugger. And he kept doing it over the years. So I learned eventually to make sure Clyde was off the top of the car.
Oh, Clyde.
What a thrill seeker.
Yeah, that's one way to get around. Rita and Prospect, what have you left on the car roof?
Well, it wasn't me. I'll say it wasn't me. It was a friend of mine. It was a big platter of fruit. We were going to a sister's place for New Year's Eve, and unbeknownst to me, I thought she'd put it in the back seat, left it on the roof of the car. But we managed to reverse out of her driveway, go through some of the back streets, but then we obviously had to come to a cross street and had to stop. She braked, because there was also a dip, braked, platter went flying. Across the windscreen, and it was we both looked at each other and going, what was that? And then realised, oh my God, it was a platter of fruit. And we were just laughing so hard. We managed to sort of...
I think we lost Rita, but we got the gist of it.
Good stuff, Rita. We'll take one more. Rosie, what did you leave on the roof of your car?
Yes, I've got another cat story.
Oh no.
Oh no.
Yes, I drove to my friend's place. I was driving through the back streets. And I got out of the car, and there was this poor Mandy staring at me, hair on end.
Holding
anyway,
on to the roof.
Yes, still sitting there. And I don't know how on earth she would have, held on. But that wasn't the end of poor Mandy, because a few months later, my son drove back out of our drive. The poor Mandy jumped off and got skittled by a car.
Oh Mandy.
No. Oh, that's sad.
That's very sad.
Three people have called in with cats on their car roof stories. We're going to award the $100 unique homestyles food voucher in just a moment. The genesis of all this was the story of Lyndall Kane that we've been talking about, who left her wedding dress in a box on the roof of the car. Jade Robren is out on the road for us. And Jade, you've caught up with Lyndall.
I most certainly did, and Lyndall is very calm on the outside, but I think freaking out on the inside. So her and her husband-to-be went out for a little journey on the weekend, and the box has been placed on top of the roof, and they drove off and have spent the weekend searching for this wedding dress. Here is a very calm, cool and collected Lyndall Kane. Well, our next guest is filthy at her husband-to-be, Tom, because he's lost her wedding dress. Lyndall Kane, good morning.
Hello, thank you for having me.
How did this happen?
The dress was in its parcel because it had been sent from overseas, and for some reason it was in the car. And then he left it on top of the car as we were leaving our storage facility.
And did it just fly off? At what point did you realise it had been lost?
When we were back in Burnside, so who knows?
You're very calm, but are you freaking out on the inside?
Yes, absolutely. I'm trying to put a smile on.
When's the wedding?
Thankfully, we've got a while. February next year.
Oh, okay. So we can reorder, we can remake?
We can redo. It's all good.
Alrighty. Have you put a reward out there? Has anyone contacted you?
Yep, we thought a reward was a good idea, but lots of reshares, lots of people caring, but no luck as yet, which is a bit sad.
What does the package look like? Has it got a name on it at least?
It's got my name. It has my address as well. And it is just a brown small box with like a DHL sticker on the outside.
How's husband-to-be feeling right now? Has he been sleeping on the couch lately?
He did not sleep on the couch last night. I think he feels very guilty.
Breakfast in bed this morning?
No, he was gone before I woke up.
Now, a good friend of mine, Christine from Couture Love Madness, called me this morning, and she's got a rack of beautiful wedding dresses. And she did say that if you can't turn it around, to please pay her a visit, and she would love to loan you a dress for the day.
Oh, that's very generous of her. That's beautiful. Thank you.
There are some amazing people out there, and I have faith that someone will find it and return it for you.
Me too. I hope so. Thank you.
Great work, Jade and Lyndall. Good test of the relationship pre-wedding, that one, just to see can you get over a stressful period together.
How much would the dress have cost?
Some astronomical figure, no doubt.
Well, people spend thousands on their dresses.
Oh, dear. We're going to award that $100 unique home styles food voucher. We might do it right after 5AA News. Breaking at 8 is next.
Nothing beats driving away in your brand new Mitsubishi, but choosing your brand new Mitsubishi comes pretty close. Thanks to the team at Agostino Mitsubishi, with over 35 years experience in excellent service. Don't miss their good to go giveaway. Purchase a 2023 Eclipse or Outlander to receive a $1,000 fuel card. Purchase a 23 Triton or Pajero to receive a $2,000 fuel card. Hurry into Agostino Mitsubishi Nailsworth or their new state-of-the-art Agostino Mitsubishi Mawson Lakes.
The very latest news and information. This is 5AA News, always Adelaide.
Sunny and 24 with the 8 o'clock news. I'm Kendall Brantig.
Chipped windscreen? Complete Windscreens can repair it from just $99. Look for the big red koala.
The SA Electoral Commission will count postal and early votes in the Dunstan by-election today, which is more than a third of ballots. While they're expected to favour the Liberals, it's likely the seat will fall to Labor. Meantime, a new opinion poll shows an increasing number of voters are losing faith in the major parties. Michael Packey has details.
The latest news poll shows Labor's primary vote has collapsed to 32%. It means if a federal election were held now, Anthony Albanese would likely need the support of independents and minor parties to govern. While the Liberals' primary vote sits at 37%, they struggle to win the preferences of other political parties to help get them over the line. The poll shows that 31% of voters have abandoned both major parties, a trend mirrored over the weekend in the Tasmanian election, with neither Liberal or Labor winning enough seats to govern the state in their own right.
And long-serving Liberal member for Grey, Rowan Ramsay, has announced he won't be contesting the next federal election. The 67-year-old and his wife have decided it's time to tackle the next chapter of their lives. Grey covers more than 90% of South Australia, including Port Lincoln, Whyalla and Port Pirie. The Albanese government's pushing for a wage rise to help the country's lowest paid workers battle cost of living pressures. The Labor government's arguing for an increase to the minimum wage to bring it into line with inflation. Tasmanian Senator Jackie Lambie's told today there are other problems which need to be addressed to support lower income sectors.
I don't have a problem with people getting pay rises. What I have a problem with is the promise of the Labor Party when the government came in and that it would remove red tape off small businesses, and all it's done is ploughed them with more red tape.
While more than 500 households per week are seeking help to pay their electricity bills, latest data from the Australian Energy Regulator shows 116,000 households are accessing hardship arrangements through their energy providers. That's a 59% increase since June 2022. A series of petrol drive-offs in the northern suburbs has resulted in an arrest. It's alleged over the past 12 months a person in a black Ford Ranger ute committed 15 petrol thefts at various servos, totalling more than $6,000. The vehicle used had false number plates every time. A 40-year-old man has now been charged, while a search of his house has uncovered a hydroponic cannabis crop and a trafficable quantity of dried cannabis. Electricity running to the house had also been tampered with. Russia's observing a day of mourning after at least 137 people were killed in an attack at a packed concert venue in Moscow. The BBC's Steve Rosenberg's there.
On this national day of mourning, there is a long queue of people outside the Crocus City Hall here, people queuing up with flowers, lining up at the makeshift shrine to the victims of this attack. And just from talking to people here, there is a deep sense of shock at what has happened. And a mixture, I'd say, of grief and also anger. One man said that he wanted President Putin to remove the moratorium on the death penalty.
And Donald Trump and his legal team are gearing up to face a New York court again tomorrow. The deadline for the former president to pay a $464 million US dollar bond is looming as he seeks to appeal a civil fraud judgment. If he fails to pay the money, orders could be made to seize his property. Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Colours, custom design, any house, any style. Gliderol Garage Doors, gliderol.com.au.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Port Adelaide has beaten Richmond by 30 points at the MCG. Travis Boak played his 350th game, becoming just the 23rd player in VFL AFL history to reach the milestone. Coach Ken Hinckley says it was a big motivation to beat the Tigers.
There's absolutely no doubt that to celebrate a milestone as great as Travis Boak's was, you needed a win. It would have been hollow for Trav to be our games record holder, a champion of our football club, so committed all the way through to Port Adelaide Football Club to play his 350th game at the MCG. I think Travis deserved a victory, and you don't always get what you deserve in life, unfortunately.
A 48-point victory for the Western Bulldogs over the Gold Coast in Ballarat, while the Giants remain on top of the AFL ladder after a 65-point win over West Coast. That rounded out the round two action yesterday. Meantime, the Crows will have a light session at Westlakes today as they prepare for Friday night's crucial away clash against Fremantle. Let's get to motorsport, and Ferrari has breathed new life into the Formula One season after a brilliant result at the Aussie Grand Prix in Melbourne. Carlos Sainz won while Charles Leclerc was second. Max Verstappen failed to finish. Lando Norris rounded out the podium while Aussie Oscar Piastri finished fourth. In the NBL, the Tassie Jack Jumpers are just one win away from securing the title after a thrilling 2-point win against Melbourne United. And there's only a couple of holes to play in the Valspar Championship in Florida, with a couple of Americans leading the way at 11 under. Cam Young is seeking his first ever win on the PGA Tour, while Peter Malnati is seeking only his second victory and first in almost a decade. Aaron Baddeley was the best of the Aussies, finishing at 4 under in a tie for 17th. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now onto the traffic.
When you cover things, they last longer. Same goes for you. Save your skin. Download the SunSmart app.
Got a crash to look out for at Hackham this morning. South Road near the Southern Expressway entry as you're heading inbound. Pretty solid delays there at the moment. Also some delays on the Bruce Water Main at Elizabeth Main North Road near Woodford Road and urgent electrical works at Prospect Churchill Road near Olive Street, speeds at 40. Cameras today, Achunga Road, Achunga and Junction Road at Balhanna. Varicose veins aren't just a cosmetic issue. Let the medical team at the Vein Institute assess the best way to restore your leg health. Visit theveininstitute.com.au. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
To the weather, sunny and 24 today, mostly sunny tomorrow, 25, sunny on Wednesday, 26 and 27 for Thursday. At the moment, 13. More news as it happens on 5AA.
The business sector has had incredible advances in AI. One solution can show you how AI can streamline your business, introducing efficiencies you never thought possible. You'll save money and time, unlock new growth avenues, and you'll be keeping up with the rest of the business community. With AI and One Solution, you can innovate, optimize, and excel across every facet of your business. One Solution will show you how. OneSolution.net.au, a Platinum Telstra partner.
Keen Office Furniture and Keen Education Furniture have the latest in office and education furniture all in one showroom. And the Keen staff love furniture. So whilst your colleagues talk politics at the water cooler, the Keen team discuss full office fit-outs and ergonomic chairs. Except last week when Shane told the team the scratches on his face were from a koala he tried feeding whilst picnicking in the Adelaide Hills. Thanks, Shane. Keen delivers and sets up furniture at schools and workplaces in Mount Barker and all over SA. Keen Office Furniture and Keen Education Furniture. Leaders in office and education furniture.
Via the 5AA Player app.
On DAB Digital Radio.
And on 1395 AM.
This is 5AA, always Adelaide.
Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on. Touch base. Search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings.
5AA Breakfast.
8 minutes after eight. How do you feel about the prospect of compulsory voting at local government elections? Give us a call, 8223 000, or text us on the Dutton's text line. It's not the government's position yet, but it's certainly one that's being considered. Local Government Minister Jeff Brock will join us after 8:30 today to talk about it more.
On the Dunstan by-election fallout as well, stick around, because after 9:15, the opposition leader, David Spears, is going to be on with Matt Pantelis in his major interview since Saturday night's debacle.
We're also going to be this half hour talking about Princess Catherine and her weekend and what it means going forward for the Royals. Some details coming out in the last 24 hours about a very relatable catch-up she had with her father-in-law about their twin battles. We'll talk about that shortly. Lots ahead on the program, but right now it's time for Breaking at 8.
Well, the other person who's on with Pants today is the member for Sturt, James Stevens, who's going to be interested in our next interview because it's with Sarah Hanson-Young. Sarah, good morning. Congratulations on a remarkable result on Saturday. Should James Stevens be worried?
Good morning, guys. Well, yeah, I think he should be, but the main issue here is that the people of Sturt, like the people of Dunstan, many of whom are in the same area, of course, in those eastern suburbs, they deserve better. And on Saturday, they sent a message to both major parties. And I suspect that come the federal election, there'll be a bigger cry for politics being done better, candidates with integrity. And the news poll out today, of course, is showing that more and more people are deserting both Labor and Liberal and voting Green.
It's an interesting phenomenon, and one we've got a lot of feedback from listeners on, and Greens voters too, Sarah, sort of assessing how this extraordinary result came to pass for the Greens party. A lot of people have said it's because of the issues with urban infill in the area. But then again, we got another text from a listener who said this is an under-30s phenomenon because the Greens are the only party that are taking the housing crisis seriously. How have you managed to be the party that gets votes from people concerned about both urban infill and the housing crisis?
We've spent the last 12 months actively door-knocking in Dunstan. That's how we did this. We talked to people who live in the area. We talked to locals. It was local volunteers on the campaign team. And our candidate, Katie McCusker, is a Dunstan girl. She's born and bred there, lives and breathes it, and wanted to stand up for her community. That's how we did it. We listened to people. We consider their concerns. And we say, yeah, you do deserve a better voice. You do deserve a better go than business as usual. Now, renters, of course, young people are very frustrated that not only are their rents ridiculously high and continue to soar, but they're getting further and further locked out of the housing market. And then there's the issues around, as you say, urban infill. You know, we need to be smart about how we build new housing stock. It needs to be affordable, but we also need to make sure that we protect the things that make a community and a neighbourhood nice to live in. And that means green spaces, community spaces, parks and playgrounds for children, safe streets. There's no point just putting in towers and then thinking everyone will be happy. You actually need to build spaces that people want to live in and want to call home.
So, Sarah, when you look at the federal electoral map of South Australia, James Stevens is now the only suburban Liberal. Boothby fell to the ALP. Seats like Adelaide no longer are marginal due to the redistribution there with Hindmarsh, with Steve Georgiana's holding that. Does this put the Greens in a position where you can just go hell for leather, all out, aiming at James Stevens when the election's held in a year or so's time?
Well, we're definitely going to redouble our efforts to increase our presence in Sturt. We've been building that up since the last election, and the Dunstan result is proof of that. Look, I'm hoping that Katie McCusker will put her hand up and be our Sturt candidate. That's what I'd like to see. Someone who is able to, you know, really show that she listens to the community, that she takes on their views, and she gets them excited about being part of a movement of change. That's what Katie's done, and I think we can do it in Sturt. I do think James Stevens should be worried. I think he is, you know, hanging on to a seat but for a party that has just is just out of touch with the local people in the eastern suburbs. The Peter Dutton mantra of from Queensland, this conservative, anti-environment, very aggressive, kind of brute type politics, pro-nuclear power all over the place. That's not what the people of Dunstan, and it's certainly not what the people of Sturt are talking to us that they want or need.
Have you got other state seats on your hit list, your target list as well? I mean, we were talking earlier with Stacey Lee about the seat of Unley, where David Pisoni, long-serving Liberal MP, is not expected to run again at the next election. Well, there's been talk along those lines. I mean, that's a seat where it had the highest yes vote for the voice to parliament in South Australia. It's got that same sort of middle-class profile as Dunstan. Do you think a seat like that could be taken off the Libs too, either by Labor or the Greens?
Well, the Greens branches in areas like Unley and also up in the hills in Hyson are definitely looking at what we've managed to do in Dunstan and saying, yep, look, our community deserves better. They want a voice for the environment. They want politics that's done and without the mudslinging. They want integrity. And they really love backing strong female candidates. Our volunteers are out on the ground in these areas and will continue to push and grow the vote across Unley, Hyson and other areas in across wider Adelaide.
Sarah Hanson-Young, Green Senator for South Australia, cock a hoop after an extraordinary result on Saturday. Thanks for joining us this morning for Breaking at 8, Sarah.
Thank you.
I'm sure that Matt and his producer, Tammy, were just chatting to him before during the 8 o'clock news break. They'll be no doubt playing a bit of that grab back to James Stevens when he comes on the show in about an hour's time.
Fascinating. 16 after 8, 8223 0000 is our number. You can text us too on the Dutton's text line, 0480 81395. Dutton's Ford, why wait? The Ranger's in stock now for immediate delivery. Dutton's, easy to do business with. The perhaps among a crowded field, it was a big international weekend of news, but I suspect the Princess of Wales releasing a video that's made clear the health battle that she's currently in the midst of was perhaps the biggest news. If you haven't heard it, have a listen.
I want to take this opportunity to say thank you personally for all the wonderful messages of support and for your understanding whilst I've been recovering from surgery. It has been an incredibly tough couple of months for our entire family, but I've had a fantastic medical team who have taken great care of me, for which I'm so grateful. In January, I underwent major abdominal surgery in London, and at the time, it was thought that my condition was non-cancerous. The surgery was successful. However, tests after the operation found cancer had been present. My medical team therefore advised that I should undergo a course of preventative chemotherapy, and I'm now in the early stages of that treatment. This, of course, came as a huge shock, and William and I have been doing everything we can to process and manage this privately for the sake of our young family.
As I was saying before, it's just the ultimate comeuppance to all of those trolls on social media with their crackpot and tasteless conspiracy theories. That poor woman, what she's going through, is just terrible.
The King's nephew, Peter Phillips, is currently here in Australia. He had an interview with Sky News Australia, in which he was obviously asked about the battles that Princess Catherine and indeed King Charles are going through at the moment with their health.
And I think for her and for the King, the outpouring of support for both of them and well wishes for both of them to recover quickly has been hugely heartening. She is she's remarkable in herself. She's without any question, she is. Her and William make a fantastic team together. Their kids are great, and they have the balance of public life and trying to be parents to three young children, which is always difficult.
It does change the entire hue of the conversation, doesn't it? Imagine having to go through chemotherapy at the same time the entire world's trying to take a photograph of you.
Oh, it's appalling.
Everyone's speculating on where you're at, what you're doing.
Yeah.
What's the big conspiracy? you're turning up and getting chemo.
Yeah.
It's hard enough.
Yeah, totally.
And going through that.
You got people trying to hack into your medical records. Mm. It's just abysmal.
Like, is it a time in your life where everyone around you tries to create an environment that is of minimal stress to you because that's absolutely critical in you getting better? I think every family that knows people that have gone through chemo understand that.
Yeah.
Well, Princess Catherine has not been afforded any of that luxury.
Some of the coverage of this has just been utterly appalling. I could not believe. We got a text about this before. I was shouting at the television last night when 60 Minutes ran this sort of, you know, with the sad piano music playing in the background, oh, Princess Catherine's courage, and then spoke to some, you know, old toff who edits Royalty magazine or something. Last Sunday, they ran a piece going, the rumours are coming thick and fast. What's really going on with Catherine Middleton? The whole thing gave air to all of the crap. You know, and this is where the mainstream media can't have it both ways. You can't simultaneously be repulsed by rumours being spread on Twitter, Instagram and Facebook and then do articles about them or TV shows about them. You know, they should be shunned and ignored. So in the space of 1 week, 60 Minutes has run this barrage of shite about this poor bloody woman, and then last night, you know, it's a tribute piece. You know, it's just nonsense.
Mm.
People, you know, media needs to have a good hard look at itself about the collective manner in which this poor family's been treated, and stop going down the social media rabbit hole, because, you know, at the end of the day, they're a family like any other family.
Mm.
And she's got to be left alone.
20 minutes after 8, let's check traffic. When the UV's 3 and above, cover up, use sun protection, stay sun smart, and download the Sun Smart app.
Thanks, Will. At Norlunga Downs, a smash on South Road near the Southern Expressway entry heading inbound. At Elizabeth Burst Water Main North Road near Woodford Road, got two lanes closed with speeds at 40, and Prospect Urgent Electrical Works there, Churchill Road near Olive Street. Quite busy at the moment to Kettlewood Terrace at Kenttown with a camera, Hawthorne Road at Mount Barker. Shell card customers in South Australia can use their Shell card at all 23 Liberty service stations across the state. Visit shell.com.au/fuelfinder for your nearest station. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
The 5AA Sports Show.
Stephen Rowe and Tim Jennifer.
Travis Boatplane's 350th.
Can I just ask the Port people a question? So, Travis Boat, the consummate professional, he is universally admired. If you go to any Crows people, you know what? We wish we had him.
Yep.
He drives standards
and doesn't look like stopping.
The 5AA Sports Show.
The G will actually suit him.
Just a champion bloke.
Weekdays from 4 p.m. on 5AA. Always Adelaide.
Need a forklift? Don't just get a forklift, get a Toyota forklift. Toyota is the world's number one forklift brand, with a great range of pallet jacks, walkie stackers and reach forklifts, right up to their leading Toyota counterbalance forklifts. Legendary reliability and safety, with cleaner, greener electric options, Toyota can tailor the right forklift solution for you. It's all part of the Toyota Forklift Advantage. For more, visit toyotamaterialhandling.com.au.
Get a Toyota forklift.
After 25 years of delivering perfect service, ACET Couriers is evolving to better reflect what they do now. They're not just couriers, they're your go-to for fast, secure and reliable national transport solutions, now known as ACET Transport Solutions. Darren, Chris and the team at ACET Transport Solutions have a fleet of over 220 vehicles delivering any size parcel and any size pallet to anywhere in Australia. Book online at acettransport.au. Don't send it, ACET.
Now, time is almost up. The life-changing Hospital Research Foundation Home Lottery's $3.6 million Henley Beach grand prize could be yours, but the deadline is midnight this Wednesday.
You could be living on permanent holiday mortgage-free in a fully furnished Scott Salisbury home in Henley Beach with $250,000 cash in the bank.
Just a leisurely stroll from the Henley Beach sunset and beachside cafes. Summer nights have never looked better. You might see Will Goodings down there strutting stuff, going for a bit of a jog.
We're trying to tell people it's a good price,
though. The clock is ticking. Final deadline is midnight Wednesday.
By purchasing a ticket in the Hospital Research Foundation Home Lottery, you can be proud that you are improving life-changing treatments and care for every South Australian. So get your tickets now at homelottery.com.au.
It all started in the back shed. Maybe it started early or late. Either way, the Olympic industry sale means there's no need to wait. With big savings on our entire range of SA-engineered sheds, garages, carports and verandas, you can afford to start something big, tough or tasty in your own backyard.
Start something with the Olympic Industries sale. On now.
Rosanna Mangiarelli here from 7 News. Join me and Will Goodings for Adelaide's leading news hour, 7 News, tonight at 6 o'clock.
Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on. Touch base. Search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings. 5AA Breakfast.
It's 24 after 8. We've got a $100 unique home styles food voucher to give away. Get unique pies, sausage rolls and donuts from your local independent supermarket. Unique. It's time for something better. We're awarding it to someone who called in a short time ago that told us about something they left on the roof of their car.
We had several magnificent calls, but we are going to give the prize to Frank with his great tale of the 16 pizzas his mum had made that were strewn all over Montague Road.
Excellent work, Frank. Congratulations to you. Don't leave the unique homestyle food on the roof of the car.
No.
Let's check the fuel out there. Avoid price spikes and save at the pump with the RAA app's new fuel trends feature. Most outlets are in the high $1.90 range and get slightly cheaper in a few. The Liberty Main North Road Blair Athol, $1.79.5. The OTR South Road St Mary's, $1.79.5. The X-Convenience Grand Junction Road, Port Adelaide's at $1.75.5. The cheapest diesel, the X-Convenience Main North Road, Jepps Cross, is $1.84.3. Now, we don't. This is a rare occurrence. We've got a return rumorphile caller, Quarterzip, called into the program on Wednesday.
I didn't see a Smeg Kettle enter the
studio. With the Smeg rumorphile last Wednesday. Quarterzip is back on the line. Good morning to you, Quarterzip.
Good morning, boys. So nice to hear you both again.
You too, Quarterzip.
And this time with the power of the rumour file and to show you what happened as a consequence. So I talked to you both about how supervision for my quite very complex disability sister, quadriplegia, epilepsy, cerebral palsy, non-verbal, all of those disabilities in her, and active overnight supervision was being stopped.
Yeah, we remember it well.
From this Saturday, or Saturday just gone, and that she had been sick with COVID and that she's had a vomiting episode into her CPAP machine, and if she hadn't had that overnight supervision, she would have been dead in the morning when they went and got her. Well, funny about some people must be listening, I think, to your show, because the next morning, the people from the NDIS, who were the ones stopping the funding for this and changing the details, called and our other sister to let us know that there would be a reprieve and that the funding would stay active for the next 4 weeks while we put together our submission and our case for why that needs to stay active. So we've been
able
that's
excellent. Great
it
news.
It is excellent. It is. And so thank you so much for letting me say my piece and for the Smeg Kettle and the power of positive persuasion that the media can give us.
Did any of the politicians talk to you about this Quarterzip?
No. Well, not to me.
No, because I got a text from someone, I'm sure she wouldn't even mind me saying it, Nat Cook, the state government minister, she sent me a text with an emoji face of, like, expressing shock because she heard your story in real time. So I'm wondering if Nat might have got involved. Someone's clearly got involved because when you were telling us, it was like, seriously? That just sounds wrong. So whoever's got involved...
Well played.
Well played them.
Mm.
Thank you.
No, thank you for calling in. We appreciate it. And it's... Look, that's... It's on our listeners. Things get changed because people 100%. That make decisions listen. They listen to this program. So if you get on and give air and you're reasonable and you give details and evidence and so forth, things can happen.
Yep.
And they do. Thank you, Quarterzip. We're delighted to hear that you got a positive outcome for your sister and all people who are in similar situations around South Australia as well. Geoff Brock's coming up, the local government minister, in a moment. We've been running a bit of a poll behind the scenes. people who are in favour of or vehemently against the idea of compulsory voting at local government elections. Call in, tell Luce or Sam on 822 300, or text us on the Dutton's text line 0848 08 1395. Let us know, are you in favour of compulsory voting at local elections or not? A simple yes or no actually will suffice, and we'll try and collate some data, get a sense of what the 5AA Breakfast audience thinks of this proposal.
I want to know
one among many.
I want to know what the fine is for not voting. We'll find out after the break.
Hello, Frank Walker from National Tiles. It's raining free tiles at National Tiles. Yes, National Tiles are giving away free tiles, but only until this Thursday. At National Tiles, buy 3 square metres of almost all of our tiles, laminate or timber flooring, and we'll give you 1 square metre absolutely free. No catches, no gimmicks, but only until this Thursday. So rush into National Tiles for your free tiles, laminate or timber flooring now before it's too late. Conditions apply.
G'day everyone, Cornsy here. Now I know a great team and I see one, and the South Australian hydraulic team I rate the highest is BL Shipway. The Shipway team are the best in the business. They've been looking after your hydraulic and pneumatic needs since 1953 with brands like Ryco, Rexroth, Enerpac, Hydac, Oilpath, EasyFit and many more. If you can't get to them, they'll send a Ryco 24/7 van to you anytime, anywhere. blshipway.com.au, a South Australian team you can count on.
Companies and small business that use one solution for their IT management, cybersecurity and AI implementation are always ahead of the curve and ready for anything. One Solution is local too, a full-service technology company right here in Adelaide, offering a diverse range of solutions across IT, telecommunications, phone and mobile systems, cybersecurity and AI. Today, more than ever, it's important to safeguard your business. Do it with One Solution. OneSolution.net.au, a Platinum Telstra partner.
5AA Breakfast is streaming live right now. To watch, simply head to 5AA on Facebook or YouTube.
This is 5AA News, always Adelaide.
Sunny and 24 with the 8:30 news. I'm Kendall Brettig.
From chips to replacements, make Complete Windscreens your insurer repairer of choice. CompleteWindscreens.com.au.
Labor is pushing for a wage increase for more than 2 million low-paid workers. Michael Packey has details.
The Albanese government will urge the Fair Work Commission to lift the minimum wage to make sure it doesn't fall below inflation. Treasurer Jim Chalmers says the deliberations must not take the Stage 3 tax cuts into consideration. He says the nation's lowest paid deserve to earn more and keep more of their money.
We are an enthusiastic champion of the low-paid in this country.
The opposition's Jane Hume argues any wage increase will likely be eaten up as a result of higher consumer prices.
They could be assisting with the cost of living in far more effective ways.
The latest news poll shows more voters are abandoning the major parties because they don't believe either is addressing key concerns.
Labor's Cressida O'Hanlon's almost certain to be Stephen Marshall's successor in the seat of Dunstan after Saturday's by-election. The Liberals' Anna Fenizio may have come away with most of the primary vote, but surging support for the Greens will see the seat switch to Labor on preferences. It's raised speculation about David Spears' future as Liberal leader. A driver's been clocked 50 k's over the speed limit at Roseworthy. Just before 8 last night, patrols were conducting speed detection duties on the Tierley Highway when a Ford sedan was picked up doing 150 k's in a 100 zone. A short time later, the car was found at Freeling. The driver, a 44-year-old man, was charged with various traffic offences and breach of bail. While a Paralawi man won't be driving anywhere for the next 12 months, police pulled over the 55-year-old at Malala late last night for a random breath test. He allegedly blew .292, nearly 6 times over the limit. Russian forces are unleashing a barrage of missile attacks on Ukraine after Vladimir Putin tried to link the country to the gunman who killed 137 people in a music hall in Moscow. More from Alison Petrowski.
Russia has staged major airstrikes on Ukraine overnight, targeting the capital Kyiv as well as Lviv in the west of the country. Polish forces were also placed on high alert after a Russian missile violated their airspace. Poland's foreign ministry says it will demand an explanation from Moscow. US Vice President Kamala Harris has refuted Vladimir Putin's claims that the gunmen responsible for Friday's terror attack are linked to Ukraine.
No, there is no whatsoever any evidence, and in fact what we know to be the case is that ISIS-K is actually, by all accounts, responsible.
Meanwhile, Russia's ambassador to the US said American officials did not pass on concrete information about a potential terrorist attack.
And a local bride-to-be remains hopeful her wedding dress will be found after it was lost at the weekend. Lyndall Kane and her partner were driving back to the city from their storage facility in Burton yesterday. She's told 5AA a brown delivery box with the dress inside was left on the roof of the car.
We thought a reward was a good idea. Lots of reshares, lots of people caring, but no luck as yet, which is a bit sad.
Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Gliderol Garage Doors, adding strength, style and safety to your home. Gliderol.com.au.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Port Adelaide's strong start to the season has continued after beating Richmond by 30 points at the MCG. The Power overturning an 11-point deficit to claim their second straight win. Travis Boak played in his 350th game, becoming just the 23rd player in VFL AFL history to reach that milestone.
Well, we love this ground. It definitely suits our game style. And look, we love to be aggressive defensively. That's probably the first and foremost thing. But then our offence comes off the back of that. And we want to be brave with our ball movement.
And there were two other games yesterday, with the Bulldogs winning by 48 points against Gold Coast, while GWS smashed West Coast by 65 points. Well, Oscar Piastri is content with his fourth placing at Albert Park in Melbourne. McLaren team bosses ordered the Australian to make way for Lando Norris, who finished third behind the two Ferraris of Carlos Sainz and Charles Leclerc. Western Australia is celebrating another Sheffield Shield title after taking it out by a whopping 377 runs. That was against Tasmania in Perth. It's the third season in a row the Warriors have won the trophy. And in some golf to finish, American Peter Malnati has just claimed his first PGA Tour win in 9 years after winning the Valspa Championship in Florida by two shots ahead of fellow American Cam Young. The 36-year-old tapping in for par to claim the win.
And an unpredictable PGA Tour season. Peter Malnati enjoys his day back in the winner's circle.
Audio there thanks to Fox. Aaron Baddeley was the best of the Aussies, finishing in a tie for 17th. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now checking 5AA traffic.
When you cover things, they last longer. Same goes for you. Save your skin. Download the SunSmart app.
Morning there, Aiden Wollonga Downs, a smash on South Road near the Southern Expressway entry heading inbound. At Elizabeth Bursewater Main North Road near Woodford Road, two lanes closed at speeds at 40. And in the park lanes, a smash on Fullerton Road near Tekeville Terrace. Cameras you'll find today at Chunga Road at Chunga and Junction Road at Balhanna. The 48-hour flash sale is on now at Amart. Buy one, get one half price store-wide across a huge range of furniture. Hurry, must end tomorrow at Amart. T's and C's apply. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
To the weather now, sunny and 24 today, mostly sunny tomorrow, 25, sunny on Wednesday, 26 and 27 for Thursday. At the moment, 16. More news as it happens on 5AA.
Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on. Touch base. Search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings. 5AA Breakfast.
23 minutes to 9. If you're watching along on the Foodland Supermarket's Facebook and YouTube live stream, you'll see that we've been joined in the 5AA Breakfast studio by the Minister for Local Government, Jeff Brock, who has taken a rather, well, it shouldn't be a novel approach because we do live in a democracy, but he's got this fantastic idea that may well catch on, that if you want to make major changes to something that affects lots of people, maybe you should ask them what they think. And we've had a bit of fun with one of these measures this morning. We've asked our listeners about the concept of compulsory voting, but there's a host of changes that are being put to public discussion that the Minister will explain to us in depth now. Minister, good morning to you.
Good morning, guys, and good morning to all the listeners out there in beautiful Monday morning.
Great to have you here.
I think it is Monday morning.
Yeah, you're right. It's Monday. It's been a long weekend in state politics, hasn't it?
Certainly has been.
I'm looking forward to the Easter one so I can have a real break.
Yeah, I bet. I reckon everybody is rocking. But just in terms of the big ticket item, I think, the one that has captured everyone's imagination the most is the idea of compulsory voting. Does the government have a view either way, or are you still in the sort of listening stage?
Can I first just go back why I've asked for this, the go to the general public themselves, because after the last council elections, as we all know, and you guys did a lot of stuff on your media about the under 30%, or just around 30% of people actually voting, which is not compulsory. So one of the things that I was disappointed, two things, in the amount of people voting in council elections. I was also very disappointed, and my own personal stuff, I was on council for 20 years, 6 years as a mayor. I'm very passionate about local councils because they are the closest to the community. Then we didn't have enough people nominating for various wards or councils across all of South Australia. And then even when we had the supplementaries, we still didn't have enough nominations, so we went to further supplementaries, which is a financial impact to those particular councils. So one of the things that I've thought, if I can go back through the local government association, who are they look after all the sector on the behalf of the councils out there, but I've decided to actually go to the people themselves, to go to the community by this Your Say website, to be able to ask them what are their views. And so far coming in, there's been a lot of interest on it, and thank you to you guys for getting it out there again, the opportunity, because I've extended it to the end of March, the 28th of March at 5 o'clock, so that's the end of this week. So what we want to be able to do is to try and get more people to fill the Your Say website out and tell me, as the minister, what their views are. And it's not only the local, it's not only the community themselves, but I'm also asking councillors themselves to put individual ones in. Councils could put a submission in, either to the local government association or attached to my department, or to the local government association themselves when they'll put one in the sector-wide. But certainly that's the reason why, and a lot of people coming in and saying, maybe we look at compulsory voting, but that'll be what the people are saying to me as the minister.
There's other things. We're getting texts from people with other elements of local government they'd like to see tweaked. I just wonder how much of this kind of stuff is covered by the survey you're conducting. For example, candidates having to list political affiliations and things like that?
They do have to do that. If they're a member of a political party, they have to put that on there. I think that came in.
Is it on the ballot form?
It's on the nomination form, and it's not on the ballot form, but it's okay. On the nomination form.
Because I think that the text is specifically about ballot forms. Is that something that's going to be looked at?
We haven't looked at that, quite frankly, but at the end of the day, is it that they have to honestly say when they put these submissions in, the application, whether they're a member of a political party. And just bear in mind that through the Electoral Commissioner, everybody gets a letter in their letterbox with all the nominations, all the CVs of each candidate, and on that they've got to have their history and if they're a member of a political party.
Are you worried it might make it more like the... I know the council elections in New South Wales are very party political. You know, you've got Green candidates, Labor candidates, Liberal candidates. Do you think that if it gets sort of... If this third tier of government gets sort of, I guess, further legitimised by making voting compulsory, will it be seen more, particularly by the sort of young Labor, young Lib types, as even more of a training ground for entering party politics?
Well, councils themselves are apolitical. They should have no political alliance in there. Should be part of looking after their particular community. Every community is different than others, and what they need to do is to be able to understand what their community wants. Now, I know for a fact there are people out there that may be a member of a political party, but they have to, they don't bring that into the chamber itself. Well, they shouldn't do that. It should be apolitical. So in actual fact, I haven't seen that in my lifetime at this particular point, but certainly the end of the day is that if we can get more people to nominate for council, mayors and so forth, and get people to actually participate in the budget discussions when they have budget discussions, things like that, I think that's going to be far better for their community so they understand where the ratepayers are going.
What would you say to a cynic like me, Minister, who says, look, when it comes to local government, all I want them to do is pick up my bins. I don't want them to go and spend ratepayers' money telling us whether to vote yes or no to referendums or anything like that. I just want the most basic services, and that if anything, rather than punishing us financially for not voting, to, you know, was the old saying, don't vote, it only encourages the bastards. You should actually be looking at council amalgamations or making councils less powerful.
Yeah, well, can I just say, this is why I've got you guys here, and I'm with you guys in the studio today. Get that message out there. We've got a survey out there at the moment. I'm encouraged the general public, who are the ratepayers of all communities across all of South Australia, including metropolitan and regional, if that's their view, if they want to put that in there as a suggestion to me, give me some ideas what the people want. My attitude is, what do the people want from their councils? What do they need? What do they want us to be able to look at? So I'll look at that, and that's why I'm on your station today, to actually get that message across to the people for the last few days.
You made a point at the start of saying part of the impetus for this was the disappointment in how engaged people were in local government and the numbers in terms of how many people had been voting. We've got people at the moment, we've got their own very non-scientific poll going on in the background, but at the moment,
good.
It's about 80% of people are saying they don't like the idea of being made to vote compulsorily. How do you engage and encourage people to vote in local government elections in the event that the survey data comes back, like ours is this morning, and says, we're not going to countenance, we don't like compulsory voting? What's plan B?
Well, we haven't got this is always plan B and plan C, but at the end of the day, I'm asking the people themselves to put that in there. Once it all comes in, and at the end of this month, end of March, and then the council submissions themselves will be coming into me, plus through the local government association. So what I'll be doing is that analysing all of those once they all come in, bearing in mind the local government association will do it on behalf of the whole sector out there, metropolitan and also regional, but also the electoral commissioner is also doing a review of the last council election in November 22. So that will come in also. What we'll do is we'll look at the whole lot, and then be able to have analyse a whole lot of that there. And then what we'll do is we'll look at the opportunity of drafting a draft bill to go to Parliament. And if that's the case, we'll then have to go to consultation also.
So just then, by throwing it up, being so open-ended and saying that it's on what people tell us, is everything on the table?
Everything's on the table. If people want to put everything, whatever they want, onto that the survey under your say, I would take that on board. I've said to people, they said, oh, well, if I say this will be stupid. Don't think anything is stupid. Put that on the content of your, and you can put written submissions in. If you don't want to go on the Your Say website, you can go into the Office of Local Government and also send it in, and then we'll take that on board also.
The other thing that's being looked at too, Minister, is the idea of term limits for councillors. How would that work? Would it mean, like, if you've run twice, you're not allowed to run again, for example? Something like that.
Again, guys, it's about what do people want, what they're going to tell me. It's interesting because there's a majority, there's over 50% of the respondents so far on the Your Say website have indicated maybe we have term limits for elected members, both mayors and councillors. So, again, I'll be guided by what comes in. This is why I've come through your station here and also through the media and going to the people themselves. I mean, I could go and get office advice from my Office of Local Government. I can go to the LGA. But what I want to do is go and ask the people. The people are the ones that I'm concerned about. The people are the ones I want to relate to. And they're the ones that either vote, don't vote, and they've also got, they're the ones that the councillors themselves have to represent.
Well, if you do want to get involved, folks, you've got until this Thursday to go to the website yoursay.sa.gov.au/councilparticipationelections. Jeff Brock, the Minister for Local Government, thanks very much for joining us in the studio this morning.
It's fantastic, guys, and have a good day. All right, thank you.
Thank you very much. We've got a call from someone who would like to remain anonymous on this suite of issues. Good morning to you.
Good morning. How are you guys?
Good, thanks, Anonymous.
Just quickly, I understand what the Minister is saying, that, you know, local council is meant to be the closest to the community, but that idea and what is happening, you know, across our state is very different. I think councils are now almost becoming a fourth, or at least I would believe the LGA is now becoming a fourth tier of government, unelected bureaucrats calling the shots, and all under the guise of democracy, because we elect people from the community. And you only have to look at the voting records of the councils as they are to see that there is a lot of factions within councils that aren't necessarily doing the best thing for the community, such as, you said, picking up the rubbish, keeping the roads tidy, and, you know, all the basics.
Yeah, no, interesting point, Anonymous. Thank you for that.
Thank you for that.
Not sure why they fairly even-handed points needed to be made under the cloak of anonymity. Maybe Anonymous works at a council.
Quite possibly.
That could be it. Yeah, who knows? Exactly, but right. Good call. Thank you. Thank you for it.
13 to 9. Let's check traffic. When the UV's 3 and above, cover up your sun protection. Stay sun smart and download the Sun Smart app.
At Nollaga Downs, residual delays from earlier smash and South Road in the Southern Expressway entry heading inbound. At Elizabeth Burstwater Main North Road near Woodford Road, two lanes closed at speeds at 40. Slow for works at O'Hallon Hill South Road near Lander Road and a camera this morning at Chunga Road at Chunga. Pet Barn Stock Up and Save is now on. Buy one, get one half price on selected food, litter, toys and more at Pet Barn. Savings based on non-member price. Ends April 1st, T's and C's apply. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Coming up on 5AA Mornings today, the fallout of the Dunstan by-election, the future of David Spears, the Liberal Party in SA, and James Stevens, the federal member for the seat of Sturt, which takes in a lot of Dunstan. And record numbers of South Australians struggling with their electricity bills. We'll tell you how to access hardship programs this morning. I'm Matthew Pantelis. Those topics, a lot more, and your calls, of course. Look forward to your company from 9.
You deserve your life-changing moment. You deserve life-changing care. You've only got 2 days to buy your tickets in the Hospital Research Foundation Home Lottery. You could win the fully furnished $3.6 million Scott Salisbury Grand Prize at Henley Beach. Plus, your tickets stay in more than 12,000 drawers, giving you a 1 in 15 chance to win. Hurry! Deadline Wednesday. Life-changing prizes. Life-changing impact. Homelottery.com.au. License M14493.
We're with Bronte Manuel from Tube and Tube Real Estate. Bronte, I'm guessing the emergence of the internet flipped the property industry on its head.
Before the internet, buyers used to view properties from a range of areas. Now they type in a specific suburb in their devices and the surrounding areas are practically invisible.
When selling, what's the trick to making sure as many people as possible know about your home?
At Toop and Toop, we have a very effective way of geo-targeting buyers, making sure the West Beach buyer knows about a suitable home in Fulham Gardens and the Medindie buyer is alerted to a home in Prospect.
That sounds very technical. Why doesn't everyone do this?
For 32 years, we've spent endless amounts of money on research and development. That's why we keep delivering record results for our clients year on year.
To find out more, go to toop.com.au.
Is there anything better than a dip in your own pool on a hot summer day? Certainly pools can take a bit of time and money, but they are worth it. But during winter, when you're not using it, it can feel like a real drain.
And that's when you put your pool to bed for winter with a Walco Guardian pool cover. It'll preserve your chemicals, keep your water clean, you won't need your pump. Just think about all the money you'll save by not running the pump for hours every day.
Then, as soon as the warm weather returns, just peel off your Walco Guardian pool cover and you're ready to dive right in. No green and gooey swamp. It'll be clear and cool and ready to take on another big summer.
So get your pool a Walco Guardian for winter now. Check out their website, walco.com.au.
At SEW Eurodrive, quality, service and delivery is entrenched in our DNA. We're the driving force in creating a competitive advantage for our customers. Visit sew-eurodrive.com.au, driving Australian industry since 1982.
Ray White Business Sales. Business people selling businesses. Go on. Touch base. Search RWC Business Sales.
David Penberthy and Will Goodings. 5AA Breakfast.
Nine minutes to 9. We're going to head out on the road and catch up with Jade Robrin in a moment. Thanks to Dutton's. She's cruising around in her Volkswagen Tiguan Allspace searching for breaking news. Thanks to Dutton's Volkswagen. But something I want to alert you to that's really important. I was at the Grange Jetty Cafe about a couple of weeks ago and spoke with the owner there about an incredible initiative they're launching for Good Friday this year. The Childhood Cancer Association Easter Appeal, which is at Grange Jetty Cafe on Good Friday, where on that day, how about this, 100% of proceeds will go to the charity.
How good's that?
That cafe is in one of the most iconic and best spots of any in South Australia.
Absolutely.
You got the view of the jetty there. You got the Grange pub just behind
you. It's
so
pretty. And
it is awesome.
Those dunes with all the little strappy, leafy shrubs, it's terrific.
So if you need a coffee or some gelato, you want to sit down and have a meal, because they do full meals right throughout the day. The kitchen's always open there. Get in on Good Friday and know that everything you buy is money that's all going towards the Childhood Cancer Association Easter Appeal. What a great initiative.
Yeah, it is a great cause. The bloke who, I don't know if he's still there, but for years, the guy who ran that cafe was a Middle Eastern bloke, an excellent guy. He used to run the Noah's Ark kebab shop in Hindley Street. That dead set, that place, if I had a time machine, I would go back and get their lamb kebab that came with spinach in it. It was unbelievable. It was just like the best Middle Eastern food, a bit like the old style Quiet Waters in Hindley Street. But, yeah, I reckon we'd have a few listeners who, after a big night at Larox, found themselves at Noah's Ark asking for a big extra dollop of hummus on the end of their kebab.
We got a call earlier in the program from radio talkback legend Rex Leverington, who called in to say one of our SMEG rumours was true. It's a big morning for the SMEG rumour this morning. The rumour file changed government policy on overnight care for people in need. But also, Rex, I've got to say, as a kid, I used to listen to him. I don't want to age him prematurely, but I grew up listening to Rex doing talkback radio. He said a few weeks ago we were warned in the rumour file of a shortage of carbonated soft drinks in shops due to a shortage of carbon dioxide. Now, he went to two Coles and there were no home brand mineral water or soft drinks in there, and said, there's something to this rumour file rumour. So we've sent Jade Robin out on the road to investigate. Jade, what have you found?
How good is it when we open the lines up to our listeners? Because they are bang on with this, and Rex is certainly onto something. I've been to a couple of supermarkets this morning. I've been to Coles and Woolies and also Foodland. Now, two out of the three, basically, the shelves are bare. So Coles was the first place I went to, and I'm finding that it's more so the home brands, the home brand flavoured waters and also the soda waters and mineral waters. So, look, a lot of them were heavily discounted. So I did think, oh, is it because, you know, they're bargain basement prices? And so I spoke to the management there and they said, no, we're actually struggling to bring it in. Popped on over to Foodland. Their shelves are fully stocked. No dramas at Foodland at all there. Went up to Woolies, and if you have a look on the Foodland live stream, you'll see some vision that I've taken. The cupboards are bare there as well, and it is predominantly, again, the home brand flavours, the mineral waters and the sparkling, you know, the mango and you know, all peach kind of flavours, mineral waters. So they're the ones that aren't around. Now, supposedly, like you touched on there, Will, that there is a carbon dioxide, a CO2 shortage. Now, the major supplier said in a statement a little while ago that short-term CO2 supply shortage is happening on the east coast of Australia, and it's due to interruptions from several local CO2 sources and issues impacting international freight for imported CO2 product. I spoke to another manager at Woolies and she said, look, we don't always stock, we're a smaller store here up in Marrickville, and we don't always stock the full range, but yes, there is not as many bottles on the shelves and they don't know when this will come back. That is one thing I noticed. The other thing I noticed, the price of Easter eggs. I don't know if I'm late to the party here, but yikes, I'm going to have to take out another bank loan for Easter this weekend.
Yeah, I know, it's a... Even the Easter Bunny's not immune from the old cost of living crisis. Unbelievable. I suppose all those interest rate, you know, rises. He's paying more to, you know, service the mortgage on his hutch. But, I wonder, there's all this supply chain stuff going on at the moment. You know, I've been totally unable to buy any Mexican beer apart from Corona for the last 3 months. Maybe it's stuck somewhere in the Suez Canal.
Well, I think that's probably part of that issue. The carbon dioxide one I find absolutely fascinating. Is this what happens when you get rid of all the coal-fired power plants, is it?
Glenn says, read your rumour, how ironic. We fall over ourselves reducing carbon dioxide. Now there's a shortage of it.
What about that? I didn't know this was one of the byproducts of the green energy future. You can't get mineral water anymore.
I'm not sure if Martin is the same guy who rang in the other day. No, it's a different person. The dill shortage, dried dill. There's no explanation. It just disappeared off the shelf. Can't find it anywhere at the local supermarkets. As I think I said the other day, going to Gagani's, they've got every spice known to man and
another
woman.
Text from someone saying, I hope this doesn't affect Cooper's, the number one ale in South Australia.
No, Cooper's going all right.
They'll be fine. Well, but presumably everyone's getting carbonation from the same place, aren't they?
Yeah, you'd think so. Hey, I'll tell you what, I reckon, can we just encourage all the normal people to get on this yoursay.gov thing about local government?
Yes.
Because the fact that the minister told us that, as things are currently tracking, there's big support for compulsory voting. I wouldn't be surprised if the only people who are actually getting on there and filling out the questionnaire so far are people who are involved in local government.
Yeah, I think overwhelmingly... Do you reckon they'd be in favour of it? I reckon there'd be a lot of really nervous people about the idea that local government becomes more mainstream. Because it would squeeze out a lot of the sort of people that have managed to carve out a little niche.
Because what? Because you think the voters will suddenly start paying more attention to it?
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'll go the other way. I just don't want to pay any attention to it.
Now, see, I'm torn because I think, yeah, I agree. I don't want to make big voting possible.
Hours researching what someone is?
No, but I think it would fix lots.
The other thing, we didn't ask the question in the end because there's no decision has been made, but our expectation is that, and we had a text from Scott along these lines, the fine for not voting will be about the same as it is for state elections, which is $20.
Mm.
But I just think, I get it federally, I get it at the state level, but fining someone any amount for not voting, I think it's ridiculous.
It feels like a perverse interpretation of the available data, which is that 70% of people don't vote. Now, is the issue getting them to vote, or is the issue that it's a tier of government that's not relevant to the majority of people?
Yeah, and you're only sort of...
And we should just remove legitimizing large swathes of it. Yeah. It just feels like a weird, biased interpretation of that.
Yeah.
But anyway, you can have your say, and as Jeff Brock told us, the minister, it's all on the table. They're not ruling anything out. So what you say will ultimately matter in this front. Now, stick around for Matt Pantelis. He's going to be a huge program this morning. David Spears is going to do his first interview at 9:15, and then James Stevens, who the Greens have their sights set on Sturt now, will also be on the program. So huge morning ahead. Stay listening. Matt Pantelis is next. We'll be back tomorrow morning from 6.
It's official.